Good morning. Good morning. My name is John Enstminger. I'm the general manager of the Southern Nevada Water Authority and the current president of the association. It is truly wonderful to welcome all of you back to Las Vegas, to see so many old friends and colleagues, and to just be together again. And while it is wonderful to celebrate seeing all of you again, we're also at a sobering moment. Since the last time I stood on this stage and closed out the 2019 CRWUA conference, our reservoir systems have lost 7.7 million acre feet of storage. 2021 was particularly brutal. We got 32% of normal hydrology, and it is now officially the second driest year in recorded history. That obviously resulted in pain throughout the basin. Just one example in the upper basin, the Dolores project in southwestern Colorado delivered only 10% of the normal supply to the farmers in that region. In the lower basin, the Secretary of Interior declared the first ever shortage condition. And while Nevada and Arizona were already making our contributions under the drought contingency plan to put more water and leave more water in Lake Mead, now in 2022, we will be obligated to cut our uses to comply with the obligations made in the 2007 guidelines. So in 2021, water was scarce and pain was plentiful. But where that leaves the people in this room, the community that shares the Colorado River, is the question: where do we go from here? It is said that a journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. But fortunately, we are not at the first step in our journey. This community has spent the last 20 years finalizing groundbreaking deals. The surplus guidelines, if you can imagine, we signed surplus guidelines in 1999. The quantification settlement agreement in California, the 2007 guidelines, minutes 316 through 323 with the country of Mexico, and then the drought contingency plan in 2019. Our basin has been a model to the world in how to gradually adapt to climate change and having less water. However, our time frame is shrinking. More action is needed, and more action is needed now. Everyone across the basin is working hard. In the upper basin, our colleagues are working tremendously hard on the drought response operations agreement to see what can be done to bolster Lake Powell elevations in the coming year and years. In the lower basin, we have now committed and will sign today the 500 plus plan, a plan that we hope eventually has more than $100 million and 1 million acre feet to protect elevation 1020 in Lake Mead for at least the next 2 years. The federal government and tribal entities will enter into agreements today whereby they will cooperate to protect elevations in Lake Mead. Our partners in the country of Mexico, we will hear about an exchange of letters that they have done that will commit them to exploring new options to further enhance protections on the river. And lastly, the lower basin states will enter into a resolution with the conservation community today that will be the first step in making sure we all work together to maximize the water that we share. This is all hands on deck. My commitment to you is to work with everybody in this room, because this is it. We are the solution. So with that, I'm going to turn to Dan Bunk with the Bureau of Reclamation, and he will go over the current hydrology. Thank you.
Thank you, John. good morning, everyone. Appreciate the opportunity to present today. I'm going to give a brief hydrology update for the Colorado River Basin. Then it'll be followed up by some remarks from the commissioner after me. So if we move on to, I think I have control of the slides here, don't I? Okay. So I know you're all aware the Colorado River has been in drought since 2000. The last 22 years is the lowest inflow period on record. The two photos you see on this slide show Lake Powell on my left and Lake Mead on the right at Glen Canyon and Hoover Dams respectively. And you can see the effect of visually on those two reservoirs. As John mentioned, water year 2021 was the second driest inflow year into Lake Powell on record. During 2021, both Lake Powell and Lake Mead reached their lowest levels since their respective fillings. So in July, Lake Powell passed below that threshold. And then in June, Lake Mead passed through that threshold. And they've continued to decline. Actually, as of today, both reservoirs are at new current low levels since they both initially filled, Powell in the 60s and Mead in the 30s. Okay, so here's a snapshot of conditions today. Lake Powell is only 28% of average at an elevation of 3540. Lake Mead, 34% of capacity at an elevation of 1065, and total system storage is at 37% of capacity. When I started working in the Colorado River Basin about 13 years ago, up until these last couple of years, we always used to say when the drought started, the system was full, but it's declined to about half full, and we're at about half full for over 10 years. Now we're at a third full. And now Lake Powell's nearly at a quarter full. So you can see the impact in particular the last couple years of the very dry years that we've had. So in terms of operations in water year 2021 for Lake Powell, water year 2022 for Lake Powell, and calendar year 2022 for Lake Mead, Lake Powell's operating in what's called the mid-elevation release tier. Under that tier, it is releasing 7.48 million acre feet. This is the second time.
Yeah, I can't hear you, Smear.
I'm sorry. Is there? Okay. Okay. So this is the second time under the interim guidelines that Lake Powell has released 7.48 million acre feet, and it's the second time since initially filling that it's released less than 8.2 million acre feet. So really reflective of the low reservoir conditions. Lake Mead, as John mentioned, is operating a tier one shortage condition in calendar year 2022. What this looks like for Lake Mead in terms of reductions, Arizona and Nevada take reductions under the guidelines and then under the drought contingency plan and then under minute 323 and the binational water scarcity contingency plan. Mexico is taking reductions as well. Those total about 613,000 acre feet, but keep in mind that there's additional conservation going on in addition to that that's not required, and then this 500 plus plan will add to that in 2022 and 2023. So how are we looking so far this year? Well, so far it's been a little bit of a mix in terms of precipitation in the basin. It started out pretty well. We had wet precip and snow in October in the upper basin, but that was followed by one of the driest Novembers on record just last month. And then this month has been a little bit of a mix where it started out dry, but as you know, we've got a little bit of precip just recently. So the precipitation to date isn't looking too bad. It's about 95% of average, but snowpack is only at 73% of median. Last year, when the runoff was only 32% of average, snowpack peaked at 89% of median on April 1st. But what we saw during the spring time frame were very dry conditions, warm temperatures, and the runoff just didn't materialize as we had hoped. So the 73% median snowpack is at this point in the year, it's still early, but it's concerning that we're not having a little bit of a better start. And I did check, they did get some snow in the upper basin yesterday, but it only bumped it up to about 75% of median. So we need a lot more of these storm events to come through the basin over the next several months. Looking at unregulated inflow into Lake Powell, as mentioned, inflow last year was 32% of average. This year, for the most probable inflow, it's forecasted at 65% of average. Due to that dry November, the forecast declined from 81% of average to 65% of average in just 1 month. Granted, again, it's still early, but not a good trend. There is still quite a bit of uncertainty, and so that's why you see the range between the 10th percentile and 90th percentile forecasts between about 33 and 121% of average. So at least there's still a little bit of hope, although we are concerned about the current trend. In terms of projections for Lake Powell and Lake Mead, these are projections from our December 24-month study and what we call two-year projections. This study is essentially being published as we speak by our ops teams in Boulder City and Salt Lake City who put these together. So you're seeing them for the first time right now. On this chart, you have Lake Powell's elevation on the y-axis, and then there's a monthly time step on the x-axis. The three dashed lines on this chart, those represent what we call the most probable forecast, as well as that 10th and 90th percentile forecast. And then we've got what we call our probabilistic traces, are those gray lines on this chart. And so the reason why we provide those as well is they provide a wider range of possibilities. So what we saw from November to December in the projections in the 24-month study for Lake Powell is that pretty much all three of those dash lines dropped by about 20 to 25 feet, somewhere in that range. And so the red dash line on this chart is now projecting Lake Powell to decline below minimum power pool as early as next fall. And then you can see there's some of those light gray lines that are even a little bit lower than that, based on the lowest inflows in that hydrologic projections. And then the most probable, the green dashed line, which is sort of that median forecast, kind of stays below 3525, which is the trigger for the drought response operations planning. And we have a similar slide here for Lake Mead. There's not quite as much uncertainty for Lake Mead as there is for Lake Powell. Lake Powell really takes the full effect of the year-to-year hydrology. Lake Mead's elevation is moderated slightly by the releases that ultimately come out of Lake Powell. But what we see here too, except for some of these gray lines on this chart, which are reflect some scenarios where we have really, really good, really high lower basin inflow, like we've saw in 2005, 1995, 1993, when the Gila River was flooding. But if you take those, if you take those hydrologies out and just say you have like a normal hydrology or drier inflow in the lower basin, then that whole cloud is, you know, every trace is in a shortage condition over the next couple years. And then we start to see the chance of dropping into a tier two shortage condition in 2023 and even a tier three shortage condition as early as 2024. So very concerning trend for Lake Mead as well. And the trigger for in the lower basin for under the DCP is when the minimum probable study is projecting 1030. It first started projecting that back in August, and you can see it still projects that as well, and even as low as 1020 by the end of this two-year period. So just a summary of all these numbers and statistics, and hopefully you don't have too much more of this today, but the drought continues through, it continued through its 22nd year in 2021. It's still early this year, but we may be into our 23rd year of drought. The large reservoirs of Lake Powell and Lake Mead are both at historically low levels. We project that as we enter into 2023, that will continue to decline as well. And for Lake Powell, unless we see a good inflow year next year. The Colorado River Basin is facing unprecedented challenges operationally due to the low reservoir conditions. I think you'll be hearing quite a bit about that and in more detail over the course of the next day and a half. And while it is still early in the season, the early winter conditions and forecasts show very low runoff could occur again this year. And as I mentioned previously, that's current forecast is about 65% of average. And it illustrates a clear need for additional action to help protect against these low elevations at both Lake Powell and Lake Mead. So with that, I will hand it on to the next speaker and appreciate your time this morning.
It is now my pleasure to introduce the Commissioner of the Bureau of Reclamation. Camille Kalimlim Touton has a long, extensive, and impressive resume, mostly serving in the legislative branch on Capitol Hill. I'm not going to go through any of that resume because the most important lines on her resume are she's a native Las Vegan. She graduated from Bishop Gorman High School and the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. So with that, Madam Commissioner, take it away.
Good morning. My name is Camille Kalimlim Touton. I am coming to you live from Interior's headquarters in Washington, D.C. My family is growing by one, and so I'm wheels down as we await her arrival. And so I offer greetings from our nation's capital as you gather there in my hometown. Today is a very special day for me. I attended my first CRWUA nearly 20 years ago, but I was in a very different role than today. At the time, I attended as an intern at the back of the room, looking up to the water leaders of the time, people that I respected as giants on the river, gathered on the stage at Caesars. I was inspired to work on water issues by seeing the people in this room and in this basin over the years come together time and time again, working together to address the challenges they faced. And as we gather today, we're still facing some of the very same challenges of declining reservoirs and low runoff that they faced. The challenges that they faced then have become ours today. Our work in this basin has not just been a professional priority for me, but a personal one. I am a Westerner. I am a Nevadan. And while I work here in Washington, D.C., this basin is my home. So it is apropos and with great honor and humility to be addressing you today for the first time in my capacity as the 24th Commissioner of the United States Bureau of Reclamation. I've had the honor to be sworn in this week by Secretary Holland, who sends her regards. And I come to this job with great enthusiasm to address the challenges facing us. I will share with you all that the past year has been one of tremendous challenge for reclamation and the people that we serve. The global pandemic has impacted our nation in profound ways. Our reclamation family is like families all across the United States and the world. We've experienced stress and separation. We've lost family, friends, and colleagues. There isn't a place that hasn't been touched. Tribal areas, urban, rural, have all been impacted by the pandemic. And as we approach the holiday season, while there has been so much progress, the pandemic continues, and we all look forward to a time of greater normalcy. As you all know firsthand, Reclamation also experienced operational challenges across the West. We're experiencing what scientists are calling the new normal, a warmer, drier West. That is certainly our reality as this administration took office. Let me tell you a little bit about the past 12 months, and let's start here in our home basin. When I joined the Biden-Harris administration in January, Lake Mead and Lake Powell were at 40% of capacity collectively. Snowpack conditions were below average, but the inflow forecasts were not as low as what ultimately occurred. What we saw in the spring was increasing temperatures and steadily dropping runoff projections. From just April 1st to May 15th, that is, in just 1.5 months, the difference between what was projected as inflow into Lake Powell declined by 1.5 acre feet. 1.5 million acre feet. That is equivalent to more than 20 feet of elevation at Lake Powell. What we know now is that 2021 was the second lowest inflow into Powell on record, only exceeded by the extraordinarily dry conditions in 2002. There are many ways to describe just how poor the runoff season was. Recall that from a snowpack perspective, last winter was not terrible. We saw over 90% of average snowpack in the Colorado River Basin. But due to warm temperatures, dry soil conditions, and uptake of soil moisture into plants, we only saw 32% of average runoff. That is a staggering difference. Think about it. Near normal snowpack, near record low runoff. To put it another way, the difference between a year of average runoff and the year we experienced at 32% runoff is the difference of approximately 7.5 million acre feet, a number with great resonance here in this basin. The impact of low runoff conditions over a period of years brought us into a new threshold in the history of the Colorado River. We declared our first shortage in the lower Colorado River Basin since a decree was entered into in 1964. And we announced the first reduction of Colorado River treaty deliveries to Mexico since the treaty was adopted in 1944. Those reductions will come into effect just 16 days from now. The formal declaration of shortage in the lower basin reflected two decades of drought and low runoff conditions that have impacted cities, farms, and ecosystems across the basin. It's not as if people across the basin and the West haven't experienced firsthand the impact of a drying basin over the years. And while there was much more press coverage of these formal declarations, a number of things did not happen and were not often highlighted. There was no conflict. There was no controversy. There was no litigation. There was an orderly implementation of objective operating criteria developed and adopted over the past two decades. The reason is clear. The hard work of the leaders in this basin, both within the seven states, the tribes, as well as our partners in Mexico, were directly responsible for our ability to manage the system this year. The leaders I looked up to and the agreements they forged years ago enabled us to successfully and fully implement the necessary reductions consistent with the August 24-month study projections. As I noted in August, when we implemented these decisions, the shortage announcement is a recognition that the hydrology that was planned 4 years ago, but we hoped we would never see, is here. And the announced actions reclamations took in August are reclamation implementing the plan as outlined by the basin agreements. I'll come back to the growing challenges we're facing here in the Colorado River Basin in a moment. But first, I want to share with you a bit of information on other major challenges facing reclamation and the West over the past year. Unfortunately, the Colorado River Basin was not unique this water year. In California, we saw a 70% snowpack. In the Sierras, we saw the lowest annual inflow into Shasta ever recorded. Shasta is the largest reservoir in the Central Valley Project system. The difference in what was projected and what was observed between April 1st and May 1st was roughly 800,000 acre feet. For those of you familiar with that system, that is equivalent to losing almost the entire storage, full storage capacity at Folsom Reservoir. This drastic change in observed runoff also changed our water year allocation from a very low but conservative 5% for north and south of Delta water service contractors to 0% that water year. We started 2021 water year with 4 million acre feet of storage in Shasta alone. We ended the year and started 2022 water year with 2.6 million acre feet of storage for Shasta, Folsom, Trinity, and New Melones combined. 2.6 million acre feet for 10 million acre foot collective reservoir capacity. Managing the system this year as those reservoirs dropped to 20% capacity was grueling. It was grueling operationally, it was grueling for our people, but significantly impacted the environment and the agricultural contractors we serve and the communities in which they live. The businesses that rely on the farms, the peoples whose jobs support those communities. We also cannot forget what Assistant Secretary Trujillo refers to as connected basins. The challenges and impacts that we saw on the Federal Central Valley Project were just as pronounced in the California State Water Project. In the communities in Southern California who rely on the SWP and the Colorado River system felt the drought more acutely. This hydrologic trend continued in places such as the Pecos River in New Mexico, the Dolores Project in Colorado, the Deschutes Project in Oregon, and the Klamath Project in the Oregon-California border. The Klamath Project is one of the oldest reclamation projects established in the early 20th century, with some families tracing their agricultural roots to the World War II veterans' homestead. This basin is also the ancestral home since time immemorial to the Klamath tribe, whose cultural and religious beliefs also stem from being stewards of the land and its creatures. The Klamath Basin is also home to the Klamath Basin National Wildlife Refuge, the first national wildlife refuge in the country. The same fact pattern we saw across the West, moderate snowpack, dry soils, hotter temperatures, was present in the Klamath Basin. And at the Klamath Project, project users received a 0% allocation. The first in the history of the project since it was constructed in 1908. This not only threatened the agricultural community, but the aquatic and terrestrial ecosystem, the tribal communities to which they are sacred, and the peace in the basin. Across the West, Reclamation was faced in 2021 with the need to manage this historic drought in the moment. It was daunting, but we responded with financial resources, operational flexibilities, and technical assistance. Basin by basin, we were engaged in our actions to mitigate the impacts of a drying landscape. We walk into water year 2022 with little relief from last year and a recognition that last year's management of the moment may be what we must manage for as a new normal. This includes the recognition that continued extremely dry hydrology combined with already low reservoir levels means we are entering into new and unpredictable territory in a matter of weeks on how we operate our projects across the West. The Washington Post commented that November 2021 put the no in no snow across the West. The atmospheric river that broke record rain events in California in November also only resulted in a 2% increase in inflow into Shasta. And while we remain hopeful that the recent snow events of this week could continue into winter, we are also faced with the hydrologic deficits across the board. As my colleague Dan Bunk just reported, here in the Colorado River Basin, in this month's 24-month study released today, shows the grim reality of potential Lake Powell and Lake Mead elevations given the decrease of 1.5 million acre feet in the projection for this water year as compared with just last month. The charts that Dan showed demonstrate the basin is at a tipping point. So, what is Reclamation doing now and in the months ahead to tackle those challenges? In August, I shared my fundamental belief. Our success in meeting the challenges in the basin of today and in the future will only occur if we do so together. Partnerships across the basin have been critical to our success over the past quarter century. Partnerships across the state, across the basin, and across national boundaries. When you look at the 2007 guidelines, minutes 319 and 323, historic tribal water settlements, the essential 2019 drought contingency plans, they all demonstrate the power of partnerships and collaboration. So if you take one thing from my remarks today, it's this. We stand ready to be a full partner with those that want to work together with us. We'll bring our creativity, our work ethic, and the experience of talented women and men of Reclamation. And you have our commitment. And thanks to the enactment of the bipartisan infrastructure law, we'll have the resources to back up that commitment. So first, let me give you a brief overview of how we're preparing to implement the historic bipartisan infrastructure law. With the enactment of the bipartisan infrastructure law, Reclamation is provided with a once-in-generation opportunity to invest in the water and power infrastructure. This new investment allows us to continue in our tradition of partnerships across the West and here in the Colorado River Basin. The infrastructure law invests $8.3 billion in water and drought resilience that will fund water efficiency and recycling programs, rural water projects, water smart grants, and new storage to ensure that irrigators, tribes, and adjoining communities receive adequate assistance and support. The infrastructure law also invests $2.5 billion in Indian water rights settlements to help the Department of the Interior fulfill its obligations to Indian tribes. The law also includes $300 million specifically for drought contingency projects in the Colorado River Basin. The law advances core reclamation mission areas of drought resilience, water supply, expanded conservation, infrastructure modernization, dam safety, rural water, and tribal trust. These investments enable reclamation to confront the need for long-term adaptation for drought and a changing climate. Reclamation is in the process of stakeholder sessions, including one this Friday, on the provisions of the law that impact our bureau. We are tasked with submitting to Congress a spend plan for the first $1.6 billion by mid-January. For more information on the bipartisan infrastructure law and reclamation's implementation, please visit our website at www.usbr.gov/bil. As those of you that have done the hard work, we know what sets the Colorado River Basin apart from other basins in recent decades, which has been our ability to collaborate, find compromises, and partnerships that work for all. At each stage, demonstrated most recently in the extraordinary state, tribal, NGO, and bipartisan support for the DCPs, this basin has avoided the easy path of conflict and has chosen the more difficult road of collaboration and partnership. A collective desire to partnership, to plan for the future. I will tell you, we had hoped to be announcing that our focus in 2022 would exclusively be on the development of post-2026 operating rules. Given where we are today, we simply don't have the luxury to turn our attention just to 2027 and beyond. As we prepare for those efforts, we simply must focus on the near-term operational challenges, both in the upper basin and the lower basins, as we plan for post-2026. Depending on the snowpack and runoff, we may be facing unprecedented operational challenges at Glen Canyon Dam in a matter of weeks. We see extraordinary risk that Lake Powell could fall below minimum power pool in just a matter of months. And depending on the hydrology and the operational decisions, Lake Powell could remain at or below power pool elevations for a long duration, months or years. You'll hear details later on drought response planning in the upper basin. We will continue to carefully coordinate any adjustments or additional releases in 2022 as we did throughout this year. We appreciate the close coordination with our upper basin partners every step of the way this year, and we'll do so in the days ahead. Turning to the lower basin, we have a more specific set of tasks. What we can say with certainty is that Reclamation intends on being a full funding partner for the 500,000 plus plan that will be signed this afternoon. We see the risks that emerged in the August 24-month study. Reclamation and the lower basin states pulled together extremely quickly and will today sign an unprecedented agreement, a pledge to work together to protect Lake Mead's elevation in the years ahead. You will hear more about the details of the 500,000 plus plan over the course of this conference. But I want you to hear from me a clear and firm commitment across the basin. We are your partners. The lower basin efforts simply will not succeed without the agricultural communities, tribes, and urban water users all pulling together to conserve more water. We are enhancing our commitments to address the scale of the short-term challenges. And in a few hours, you will see real commitments to reduce water use to protect the system. Both the Gila River Indian community and the Colorado River Indian tribes have stepped up to make new commitments and help reduce the risk of Lake Mead falling to lower and more precarious levels. Working with our funding partners, Arizona, Nevada, Central Arizona Water Conservation District, the Southern Nevada Water Authority, and the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California. We are dedicating truly significant funds for DCP implementation and the 500,000 plus plan. Our funding commitments are nearly seven times what went towards the pilot system conservation program in the lower basin from 2015 to 2019. $200 million in 2 years demonstrates the seriousness of reclamation and the MOU parties. While it is neither a permanent or complete solution, it is the right next set of steps to take to implement the DCP commitment to work together to protect Lake Mead. While we begin to contemplate the larger strategies and bigger questions, we can simultaneously do good and further reduce system risk, but only if we work together on collaborative and innovative projects. It is said that the people who work in the business of water are in the business of the future. The decisions that we make today provide the foundations for the decisions of the next generation. The plans we are implementing today are because of the collective partnerships across the basin that span nearly a century since the signing of the compact in 1922. 20 years from now, can the next generation of leaders on the river come to this conference and say the same thing we are able to today? Say that we had the foresight, that we had the willingness, and that we had the desire to partner to face the challenges of today and the future? When I appeared before the Senate earlier this year, I emphasized that the drought has very real implications on people and the environment. Farmers whose life's work is to put food on America's table worry about the ability to put food on their own. Tribal communities who too often have seen their dreams denied and delayed, who fear the loss of species of cultural significance. Communities who see the low reservoirs and worry about their water supply. Ecosystems and species that are stressed to the brink. As commissioner, and as a commissioner facing a historic drought, but bringing to the table significant resources, I know that we alone cannot solve the extraordinary challenges ahead. But we can do our very best if we work together as partners. Reclamation brings a proven track record of collaboration and communication, and I am proud to lead the 5,400 public servants who make up this organization. We humbly face these challenges with a commitment to work with you, our stakeholders, our partners, our colleagues, to address the challenges of today and tomorrow, and to work together as partners. Thank you all, and I hope to see you all in person soon. In the meantime, I wish that you and your families have a safe and healthy holiday season.
Thank you for that, Madam Commissioner. I'm gonna ask the next panel to step up a few minutes early. We've got a pretty wealthy and knowledgeable group here. I got my, thank you. Okay, thank you everyone. We have five speakers on this panel and just about an hour's time. I'm gonna ask everyone to try and stick to around 10 to 15 minutes and just give a really brief introduction to some of the planning committee's thoughts that this CRWUA should look and feel a little bit different. We were not looking to have an upper basin panel and a lower basin panel and a tribal panel. We were trying to integrate those viewpoints into many different panels today. And this panel was really focused on hitting on some of the major challenges that the basin is facing and the way that we're responding to them. Since the substance here is worth a lot more than the introductions, I'm gonna skip over introducing these panel members. They've all got fantastic resumes you can find on Google. And I'm gonna ask Maria Dadgar to set up. She's with the Intertribal Council of Arizona and talk with you about some of the tribal challenges in the basin.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, there we go. Good morning, tribal leaders, water officials, Colorado River advocates, and guests. My name is Maria Dadgar, and I serve as the executive director of the Intertribal Council of Arizona. I am an enrolled member in the Piscataway Tribe of Southern Maryland. Whenever you hear Secretary Holland give a public speaking engagement from Washington, D.C., you always hear her start with a land acknowledgement for the Piscataway people and the Anacostia people. And although there are no longer any Anacostia tribal members alive today, the Piscataway people still exist. And so I am a member of the Piscataway Tribe of Southern Maryland. It is customary whenever we as Indian people visit an area to give an acknowledgement of the people that are local to this area, the local indigenous people. But before I do that, could I respectfully ask all of the tribal leaders and tribal council members that are here in attendance today to just quickly stand and be recognized? Just take a moment. Thank you. Thank you, tribal leaders. I have to tell you, I have 21 bosses, and several of them are here, so just bear with me. I enjoy my job. It's an honor to serve as the executive director of the Intertribal Council. With that said, I would like to acknowledge that we're here on the ancestral homelands of the American Indian tribes that have inhabited this land for centuries, including the Southern Paiutes, Washoe, Northern Paiutes, Western Shoshone, and Hualapai tribe. Forgive me if I've left out anyone. I also acknowledge and pay respect to Indigenous elders, past, present, and future, who have stewarded this land throughout the generations. I'm honored to be here this morning. I have about 9 slides to go through, and I just want to share about our organization, and I think that will help you form a framework of how I work with our tribes in Arizona and actually throughout the region and nationally as well. So I'll start with my first slide. I guess that's on me. So we actually have 2 organizations that we're running. We have, how do I go back? There we are. The Intertribal Council of Arizona, better known as ITCA, and we also have a political advocacy arm, the Intertribal Association of Arizona. So I'll start with ITCA briefly. The Intertribal Council of Arizona is a tribal consortium of 21 of the 22 tribes in Arizona. There is no occasion where I, as the executive director, speak on behalf of our tribes. And we have our board of directors that are the highest elected officials for the 21 tribes that are members of our organization. Through ITCA, we have 65 subject matter experts on staff. The predominantly are members of tribes either from Arizona or throughout the United States that work for the Intertribal Council of Arizona. We operate over 60 federal grants. Our annual operating budget is about $27.5 million. And we operate grants not only for the tribes in Arizona, but we operate grants, federal cooperative agreements, and contracts within the region. You all may know that the United States tends to divide tribes up throughout regions. And so we, in Phoenix area, we happen to be within the BIA Western region. And so we operate contracts on behalf of the BIA throughout the region so that the Western region would include all of the tribes in Arizona, Nevada, and Utah, about 49 tribes. And we work with the tribes daily, weekly, throughout the year on all different types of programs and projects. The Navajo Nation is not a formal member of our organization, but we do work with Navajo and President Nez often. We also have a political advocacy arm. That is the Intertribal Association of Arizona, or ITAA. Same board of directors, the highest elected officials for tribes in Arizona, but it's through ITAA that our tribal leaders serve as our best advocates. We go to, well, prior to the pandemic, we would go to Washington, D.C., and educate and inform our legislators, also advocate. And if you ever visit a tribal community and see a new hospital or clinic or even funding, such as the funding that's coming down through the infrastructure funds, you have to know that it has taken years and years and years of advocacy. And it is through our tribal leaders in Arizona that we advocate on issues of importance to one or more tribes. And so I will move on now. I always like to start with a map just to see the number of tribes that we have in Arizona and the tribal lands that tribes are in control of. It's about 28% of Arizona's land base that tribes are actually in control of. And so this is a picture from the Tribal Legislative Day. Once a year, all of the tribal leaders from Arizona descend on the state capitol. And we have meetings with state officials there, but it is a time when tribes come together. And so just to briefly share our mission of our organization, it is to provide its member tribes with a united voice and the means for united action on matters that affect them collectively or individually. That is our constitution. I always like to say ITCA and ITAA is policy in action. Our tribal leaders are very, very knowledgeable. They lead this effort to advocate, inform, educate, our legislators on issues that are important to either one tribe or all tribes. And at this stage, we were established in 1951, so 70 years that ITCA and ITA have been in existence. We became a 501c3 in 1975, so about 46 years we've been operating federal grants and contracts. The role we serve really is to help federal agencies live up to their federal trust responsibility to the tribes. Again, it is not my role as executive director or any of our 65 staff members to speak on behalf of tribes or tribal leaders. We are there to facilitate the communication between federal agencies and whatever administration is in office and our tribes. People usually ask me to speak on what is the tribal perspective? What is the tribal perspective on this or that, or on health, but on water? They usually ask me to speak on that, and really I just want to help everybody understand that there is not one tribal perspective. We have over 500 tribes, approximately 574 federally recognized tribes in the United States. Each tribe is its own government, its own languages. They have their own origin stories. Each are to be respected as individual sovereign nations. And so we can't really say there's one tribal perspective, which is usually what I get asked to speak on, but I'd rather think of it more as we have shared beliefs. And so I'll just share. This will work. It seems to be frozen. It's not moving. There it is. Okay. And one more. There we are. So I think that all of us here can agree, whether we're indigenous or not, water is essential for life, and therefore water is life. That is a shared belief. We also believe that where there is a body of water, this is a sacred place. And we recently held a global water summit with tribal leaders from New Zealand, the Maori people. And we found that we shared this in common with them as well, and that is the health of the people correlates with the health of the river. And so if you understand that, you'll begin to see the worldview that tribes have when they approach their work around negotiations for the Colorado River. And this is just a synopsis of some of the recent things that have happened, the management activities around the Colorado River. And I'm just listing them here for you to keep in mind that tribes have had an integral role in all of these management decisions that have taken place and continue to have an integral role. This was just a moment in time, not that long ago, in 2019, you know, everyone, you know, their smiles and happiness, but we know that these moments in time right now with the drastic changes happening in the river due to climate change and over-allocation, we have to admit it, we can see that we'll continue to have these moments in time where we can celebrate for a minute, but we've got to just continue to buckle down and find ways to work together. Okay, there's more to, there we go. Okay. So, you know, you've heard it so many times. Historically, tribes have not been a part of the negotiations around the management of the Colorado River. And let's just say that's past history, because that is no longer the case. Tribes have played a critical role in the implementation of the drought contingency plan. And as we continue developing new plans, I think we heard Commissioner Touton talk about the 500-plus plan. We are going to see that tribes are here to play an integral role in all of the Colorado River management decisions. And so this is just about at the end of my presentation. This was the title of our workshop today, the change of plans, addressing new challenges. I just have a few key bullet points there to say that we should look at tribes and think of tribes as key stakeholders. Tribes are building their capacity individually, but what I have found that may be unique to tribes is that we build our capacity collectively. And so you see three logos there. You'll see the Intertribal Council of Arizona, and in the middle, our Tribal Leader Warner Policy Council. That council is about 16 years old. It was created by tribal leaders for tribal leaders to serve as a platform to hold conversations and dialogue discussions with state and federal entities, as well as tribal leader to tribal leader. And then we ITCA works through creating work groups, and that will be tribal attorneys, tribal leaders, experts. And we had a working group which evolved into a new program, and that is the Colorado River Tribal Roundtable. This is normal for us. We've been around for 70 years. This is just how we work. And so we've created a logo to identify and brand the work that tribal leaders are doing around the Colorado River. We, through the Colorado River Tribal Roundtable, we signed an MOU with the Bureau of Reclamation, and it's really just a, I always like to say, a handshake on paper to say that we will be working together. Again, our role is just to serve as a platform to provide opportunities for those discussions to take place. And we, at the Intertribal Council of Arizona, we have extensive relationships around the world. People think, oh, you're from Arizona, you're a tribe, you just know each other. What you have to know and remember that we work throughout indigenous communities around the world. We have a very strong relationship with some of the tribal leaders in New Zealand, the Maori leaders, and we've also been contacted by First Nations tribal leaders in Canada who wanted to come today, who are watching and asking and wanting to know about how things are going for us. It's out of concern, but just know that when conferences like this take place, it's, you know, we've got to remember that this is actually probably something that people around the world are paying attention to. And then just know that tribes, tribal leaders, as they work on approaching the negotiations, that they will be focusing on values and there will be a spiritual and cultural aspect to their work. And that's it. Just want to thank you for the time today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maria. Next, I'm going to quickly switch over to Sara Larsen. She's with the Upper Colorado River Commission.
Okay. Thank you. Can you hear me? Okay. good morning, fellow Colorado River friends, colleagues, enthusiasts, and devotees. It's wonderful to be visiting with you here in person, especially. And I just want to take a minute to remember a couple of years ago when we left CRWUA, I don't think anybody could have anticipated what was going to be in store for us next. Both with COVID and hydrologically, it was just unprecedented. And so it's worth taking just a minute to appreciate learning from each other face-to-face, listening to each other and engaging with each other directly. And I really hope that we'll be able to do this again. We'll be able to continue to meet in person. It's just so much more satisfying to be able to visit with each other this way. My name is Sara Larsen, and I am currently serving as the Interim Executive Director for a few more weeks at the Upper Colorado River Commission. And I've been asked to speak to you a little bit about demand management, both just in a general way, and then also to give you an update as to the Upper Basin's feasibility investigation into such a program. And those of you who know me know I like to throw in some fun memes and jokes. And I had some slides, and after getting a preview of the hydrology, I just thought, you know what, this is pretty important and sobering business, so I took them back out. But I hope you'll still enjoy. Let's see here. Am my slides up? Can you put up my slides? Thank you. Here's my Zoom. Okay, there we go. Okay. My good friend, Don Osler, who's here, by the way, be sure and tell him hi, took this photo at Hoover Dam earlier this spring. You saw some pictures earlier today that had an even more dire view of the storage in the reservoir. So this picture is outdated even now. And things weren't looking great in the spring. Same thing, this photo is from Candace Hassenjager, and she took this a little bit after Don's photo. And unfortunately, these pictures really demonstrate for us the takeaway message from this conference, which is we are just simply facing an unprecedented time here in the basin of stress and challenges. And so while there's bound to be variability from year to year, It's really important to acknowledge and talk about that long-term decline and drier hydrology. And over the last 20 years, and especially this past year, I mean, it was just crazy bad, as my kids would say, just crazy bad. With that in mind, my Upper Basin colleagues and I have been very hard at work over the past couple of years, and even more so the last 6 months, to address the two primary components of the Upper Basin drought contingency plans. Pat is going to talk a little bit more about the Drought Response Operations Agreement, or the DRUA, as Don likes to call it. And unless you've been hanging out in the Slot Canyon for the past year, you know that the DRUA is in full swing. We're working very hard on that. Demand management is in full swing too, but it's been a little bit more behind the scenes. So hopefully by now you know the old refrain, temporary, voluntary, compensated. That's a pretty good encapsulation of a demand management program. But in case you don't think about demand management on the daily, let me give you a recap of some of the most important points. The demand management storage agreement authorizes the storage of water conserved under an upper basin demand management program in the Colorado River Storage Project, or CRISP initial units. Those are Flaming Gorge, Aspinall, Navajo, and Lake Powell, without charge, and for the purpose of helping to assure continued compliance with the Colorado River Compact. And that authorization does not expire. The agreement does not establish an upper basin demand management program, but by securing that storage authorization, the UCRC and the upper division states can effectively consider the feasibility of a demand management program. The agreement sets forth the minimum conditions under which the upper division states can access that authorized storage by 2026. And importantly, the UCRC and the upper division states must independently approve a program. If after study the UCRC determines that a demand management program is feasible and as agreed to independently by each of the upper division states, then it may develop and implement a program. And of course, lots of issues exist that need to be investigated. The consistency of a program with existing federal and state law. So what in our authorities either constrain or facilitate a demand management program? Protecting existing water rights and existing communities. The feasibility of such a program, accounting for conserved consumptive use volumes, administration, shepherding of those volumes down to their units. Funding, that's a big one. And economic and environmental impacts of that program. All of these need to be investigated before we can determine whether or not a program is viable. Where do I point this? Ah, there we go. Okay, a few more points. Demand management water stored prior to 2026. Upon verification of that conservation and conveyance, that volume will not be subject to release from Lake Powell through 2057, except upon the request of the UCRC for compact compliance purposes. It cannot cause a different release than would otherwise occur under operational rules. That volume would have been consumptively used but for conservation as part of a demand management program in the year of participation, and it can't be from an unused apportionment. The maximum combined storage limit is 500,000 acre feet, and that is subject to a proportionate share of evaporation. It can be reduced by a physical spill from Glen Canyon Dam, which is just interesting to consider. And is also subject to annual verification and reporting. So after 2026, any demand management storage program would be informed by and considered as part of our post-2026 operation negotiations. All right. So here's our roadmap. You have four blocks here on the process or procedures for such a program. The first one is to determine feasibility. The second one would be to develop an actual demand management program. Then we need to reach an agreement with the Secretary of Interior that might involve a NEPA process. We also have to consult with our lower basin colleagues get agreement there, and then seek final approvals. So we have a long road ahead of us. This is not just a feasibility study and then we're ready to go. There's a little bit more to it than that. And I would say right now, we are in block number one. We are still determining feasibility. Okay, so on to UCRC. Where are we in this current process? Many of you know that the UCRC received a grant from Reclamation to conduct the study. And the focus of our study is more on the interstate perspective. So the states all have processes in place to study intrastate demand management. The UCRC is a little bit higher level than that, more across the states. We are determined to stay integrated with those intrastate efforts, and the way that we do that is through the Demand Management Committee that has representatives from all of the upper division states, and that DMC, the committee, acts as a conduit between those intrastate efforts and our investigation. So we're trying to stay very tightly integrated together. At the outset of that grant period, we solicited and hired some contractors to help us with that work. They are working on specific categories in the investigation. We have project management, we have legal feasibility, we have a technical group that looks at modeling of reservoir storage and routing under various demand management scenarios. We have a technical component for looking at how to determine conserved consumptive use volumes and verify those volumes. We have a contractor looking at the economics of the program, both the primary and secondary impacts. And lastly, we have a stakeholder and outreach team for when we need to engage further with all of you. That work really got underway earlier this year. Our DMC crafted some scopes of work and then some task orders that were related to those scopes of work and got to work issuing those with our contractors. And we've been under an iterative review process since that time, taking in those materials, returning them back, getting through this process. We had originally anticipated being able to use the time until the end of the grant period, which is September of 2022, to conclude our investigation. This past summer, with the dry hydrology and our declining reservoir storage, and also the triggering of the other part of the DCP, the DROA, we really feel like it's necessary to expedite that work as much as possible, and we're going to try and do that. We're trying to do that. So, also knowing that there is still a lot left to do. One thing that might be helpful, we're going to add some information to the UCRC website, both general information and some status information as to the investigation for you, and hope that that will be helpful and at least let you know where we are in that wider process going forward. So until that time, I want you all to just relax and think snow. I did this last night and then we got hammered in Salt Lake City, so you know, we'll take what we can get. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And next, I'm going to turn it over to Pat Tyrrell, who's going to talk about DROA.
Uh, Good morning, everybody. I wanted to thank the other speakers up here today, those who've spoken, and then we still have Tom as well for the points they're making, but especially the first two speakers we heard this morning, CRWUA President Enstminger and Commissioner Touton, both outlined what I think is a very important part of this particular meeting. This is unlike, I've come to these for 20 years, and I think the issues before us this year are far more substantial than any other meeting I've been to. And I think we need to recognize that. I really agreed with Sara and appreciated her comments at the beginning that you want to have fun while you're at CRWUA. This year it's a little harder to have a whole lot of fun. We need to recognize the words that came out earlier this morning and take them to heart and really show the work that's going on and get that work done. It's just too important. So I should have a presentation too. There we go. We're going to talk a little bit about the Upper Basin Drought Operations Planning. This is part of the 2019 DCP for the Upper Basin. Sara mentioned the demand management that she spoke about. Drought operations is the second leg, and then the third one that did not require federal legislation but was a part of that plan nonetheless is continued weather modification or cloud seeding in the Upper Basin, and I think that is still moving ahead. I know in Wyoming, while we're not going to talk, maybe it'll come up later during these meetings, but just in Wyoming, for example, we are moving some generators to better spots where we are working in the Sierra Madres to complement air-based seeding with ground-based emitters. So that part of our work is ongoing, and I didn't want to not mention it. So my goal here today is really provide an update. What is DROA? Where are we? What happened to us in 2021? And what does 2022 look like, at least today? This was part of our original DCP, and the Drought Response Operations Agreement was embraced in that larger plan. Let me give you a little background as to why that agreement even exists. It's there because in the Upper Basin we have a different secretarial role than in the Lower Basin. There is no water master role. You have four state engineers, four individual states, and the Bureau really is more of a water right holder and an operator of reservoirs than an overall water manager. What that means is those reservoirs are owned by the Bureau, operated by the Bureau under rods and other agreements, but when the time might come that Lake Powell is facing what it is facing, we all knew that the Bureau would, in their operational calculus, they would need to do this, consider protecting Lake Powell. That's going to require the movement of uncommitted water from other units, other initial units. DROA came about because the states wanted to be an influential partner in that process. Those reservoirs are Bureau facilities. They are also serving state users, state recreation, many other purposes that the states and our stakeholders want to be a part of if it means moving water out of them. So, to the extent that the states can be a partner and influence how DROA occurs, that was the genesis of why it became part of the DCP. The goals of that program are to minimize the risk of Lake Powell and its important operating characteristics such as compact compliance, hydropower, everything from there on down. Everything associated with Lake Powell is critical to the operation of the whole basin. Not to minimize the purposes of the other reservoirs, but Lake Powell certainly has its place very high on the list. So we need needed to try to protect Lake Powell from falling below the target elevation of 3525, which is about a 35-foot buffer on top of the power pool. We're not quite sure how the lake will operate if that water elevation, as it approaches the top of the penstocks, cavitation, full pipes, how else can we get water out of the reservoir? So that's the reason for the 3525. This DROA plan really provides a process to develop a drought operations plan and make those operational adjustments, first looking at Lake Powell, and then looking at the possibility of releases upstream. And the plan looks only at the initial units, which include Lake Powell, Navajo in New Mexico, the Aspinall unit and its reservoirs in Colorado, and Flaming Gorge. Here's a diagram. Many of you have probably seen something like this in recent weeks, just showing where those units are. Right now, as you can see, Flaming Gorge looks pretty good at the moment at 77% of live storage, Blue Mesa at 27, Navajo at 52, and Lake Powell at 28. So we do have some storage in the basin, but it certainly isn't flush. Right now, if you look at Lake Powell, we're at 3540. So we're 15 feet above the elevation sought to be protected by DROA. Here are the timeline of events that we saw in 2021. And I note that Commissioner Touton mentioned earlier that it was either April to May or May to June, we lost 1.5 million acre feet. If you go all the way back to the January-February timeframe, our loss was 3 million acre feet, maybe more, depending on the estimate you look at. But it was clear, even in January, our minimum probable 24-month study projected Powell to go below 3525 in its outlooking period. There was, at that time, then formal notification of the parties. We enhanced our monitoring and coordination and began monthly analysis of the most probable min and max conditions. In May of 2021, as we saw snowpack dwindle and concerns were raised, the most probable run of the 24-month study projected Powell essentially within a few inches of 3525. At that point, our drought response operations agreement planning portion was formally initiated. In July of 2021, conditions continuing to get worse, we saw the initiation of DROA releases under the Bureau's and the Secretary's emergency abilities and authorities that are within that document. From July to this month, a total of 161,000 acre feet of water were released from Aspinall and Flaming Gorge to get intended to go to Lake Powell. This might be a good time to mention and tag on to what Sarah said. We were quite busy working as states and as UCRC on our demand management contracts and feasibility studies as all this timeline of events started unfolding. If you're one of the smaller states, I guess in terms of population, Wyoming is the smallest, probably not much of a contest. That is a shift in staff effort that happened almost immediately. To that extent, we ourselves are somewhat disappointed in the lack of progress we made in a few months this year on demand management, simply because that work had to shift to this DROA analysis. Where am I at on my slide? So we released about 161,000 into December, beginning in August, and to give you an idea of how busy things got, with the Bureau's help and the work of all the states and the Commission, 8 different work groups were established, not unlike what Sara described as the handful of different contracts that we have looking at different components of demand management. So each one of those groups took on a separate task. I don't have the full list of them, but I think it's fair to say that they were quite busy. We approached the DROA in the creation of 2 different documents, a framework document that will be durable and manage as the overarching guidance for any future DROA activities, and then the creation, and I'll get to this in a moment, of what we call the attachments, which are specific to the activities that would take place in any one year. As those documents were pulled together and the writing was combined so that it was a cohesive document, meetings were held. We have had meetings with tribes and affected federal agencies in that process. These are the 2 components I was mentioning earlier. The framework, this slide calls it a static portion. It is the durable guidance that any future annual or necessary plan would fall within. It covers the general release and recovery principles. Recovery of these reservoirs after a DROA release was a concept that the states worked very hard to get into the DROA documents and into the DCP legislation, because if that water is moved downriver, we have to have a plan to get it back somehow and get those reservoirs back to where they are not suffering that loss long term. So the framework plan covers general release and recovery, operational adjustments at Lake Powell, descriptions of each unit operations, effectiveness / futility. If we release water, how much of it, any of it, all of it going to get to Lake Powell, that type of analysis, natural resource considerations, impact to hydropower, water release distribution, what time of year do we do it, transit losses, you can read the rest of that list. It's pretty thorough. The attachments get attached to the back of the framework document in a particular year, describe the actual drought response operations for the year, and any adjustments, recovery that occurs in that period. That attachment, the set of attachments that are being contemplated at this moment, cannot be finally developed until this spring when we really know what the hydrology for the year is looking like. So our next steps in this process are the final draft of the framework should be available and complete by the end of the year. It will be available for review and comment in January, including at least one public webinar. The DROA parties will begin developing the attachments for 2022 as we follow the snowpack through the winter. There will be a separate opportunity for review and comment as those documents are prepared. If a plan is necessary due to the hydrology, you can in 2022, you can anticipate plan finalization in April of this coming year. Right now, Lake Powell is projected to fall below the target elevation during the March to April timeframe. So the Bureau is currently considering making operational adjustments at Lake Powell right now prior to April to protect that target elevation. I think it's important, the last note on this slide, that those operational adjustments, should they occur, do not affect the annual amount of water that's moved out of Lake Powell, simply the timing of it. That's my presentation, Colby, and I want to thank everybody. Great to see the fabulous interest in this space.
Thank you, Pat. I'm actually going to go next, because I got the job of moderator and talking about municipal conservation. So I'm going to breeze through some of this quickly, but my point here is twofold. Even within the lower basin, we often get asked, what is Nevada doing? Absent the agricultural production of Fort Mojave, all of our uses here in this urban area that you see. So there's not a lot of opportunity for partnerships across different water use industries. So we play a really aggressive approach to urban conservation as our plan for how we steward the river into the future. While I'm only going to talk about what Southern Nevada is doing, I would say that conservation is unique to each community and their water resources, and we're not the only community implementing water conservation. So with that, hopefully my slides come up. Maybe, maybe not. There we go. Okay, so it's really dry here and we got a lot of people. Next. I'm going to try and go through this quickly to give Tom a little bit of my time. So Southern Nevada has been incredibly successful at implementing urban conservation since 2002. 2 years into this drought, our population has increased by 52%, and our draw of Colorado River water has been reduced by over 23%, all because of urban water conservation practices. We implemented what were considered some of the most aggressive conservation policy in the United States in the early 2000s, and that included really focusing on what constitutes this community's consumptive use of Colorado River water. Since we return most of our treated wastewater to Lake Mead, that means outdoor water uses. So we implemented development code to restrict where you could have turf in the desert that we live in. No turf in front yards, only half of your backyard, mandatory watering restrictions for time of day and day of week. We limited aesthetic uses of water. We started a water waste enforcement program and our cash for grass program, which has become sort of the hallmark publicly of what we've done. We've reduced the amount of turf in this valley by 200 million square feet of grass since that program began in 1999. Watering restrictions. We have seasonal and time of day watering restrictions. There is a special place in hell for somebody who lives in the desert and waters their grass 7 days a week in the winter. It's completely inappropriate. But people are lazy and they don't like to get up and change their watering clock. So we invest significantly in reminding people to get off their bum, walk out in the garage, and take 3 minutes and adjust their watering clock. And that's borne some fruit for us. Our compliance rate has increased from about 40% in 2019 to over 62% this year. About a 15% increase in water use savings above these nets us almost 30,000 acre feet of water per year. So a very significant water savings associated with managing how much water we're using to irrigate our lawns and landscapes. So now I'm going to shift and talk about how this integrates into our water resource planning and some of what we're doing here locally to make sure we're planning for a dry enough future. A lot of what's in this next portion of the presentation is not approved by the SNWA Board of Directors. It's on the agenda for next week, which has been properly noticed and posted. So I'm talking with you today about things that we are actually proposing to our board. When we look over this current drought, nearly half of the years of these last 22 years have been below 11 million acre feet. And as you'll hear on the panel following us, the future is expected to continue to be drier. The driest scenario that we used in our water resource plan last year was a 12.9 million acre foot inflow. That inflow scenario results in Lake Mead's elevation like you see here, spending a lot of our time in the lowest and deepest level of shortage. It represents about the 33rd percentile of the CMIP 3 data for projected inflows to the basin, but we don't think this is dry enough. Why? Because the last 22 years were drier than this. The other thing that that plan did that we had last year was had a conservation goal of 105 gallons per capita per day by 2035. So when we fast forward to this year, we are looking to plan for an 11 million acre foot inflow. This is perhaps not the lowest inflow that we may see, but we think it's a prudent step down from planning for this current drought being the driest we may see. And when you apply current policy to an 11 million acre foot inflow, you see that Lake Mead is bouncing along the bottom of the reservoir for the entire 50-year period. We take those inflow scenarios and we look at our conservation progress, our projected population growth, and we see what type of water resource scenarios we're going to need to meet the future uses of this community. And in doing so, we found that our 105 gallon per capita per day goal is insufficient. We've rolled up our sleeves, we've looked at what can be done, and we're asking our board to adopt a new goal of getting our water conservation to 86 gallons per capita per day by 2035. We require that incredible level of urban conservation in order to continue to meet the economic diversification goals of this community and to address the upward pressure of climate change. Because all other things being equal, our demands will go up as a result of climate change. So we're not only fighting to get our use down, we're fighting the upward pressure that climate change is projecting on our demands as well. In fact, we estimate that could be as high as 9 gallons per capita per day just by 2035 that we see our water users' behavior change in response to warming temperatures. So we have a lot of actions taking place today in order to address climate change, some landscape efficiency programs looking at how we can decrease the water use associated with cooling towers, controlling our water losses by appropriately managing our infrastructure, that compliance piece that we talked about, and making sure that new development starts as water efficient as possible so we're not chasing those conservation gains continually into the future. We know we have the community's support to do this. In 2006, the scale for support for conservation was about 60%. As we sit today, our community's support for doing water conservation is over 84% of the population supports us implementing aggressive water conservation measures. So these are some actions that I'm just going to go through very quickly of things that have been approved recently and that are going to be presented to our board in the near future. The first is no new golf courses. 70% of our member agencies have adopted a ban on future golf. It's a very large consumptive use, and it's no longer appropriate in this desert community. Septic systems. Since we return water to the Colorado River, there is one way that our indoor use gets lost, and that's through septic uses. Again, 70% of our service area has adopted a restriction where you cannot be served Colorado River water if it is discharging to a septic system. Our out-of-valley use areas for all of our municipalities are restricted from developing in a way that does not allow them to return water back to the Colorado River, and we're working to get the rest of the municipalities to adopt that in-valley as well. Our legislature passed a bill prohibiting non-functional turf. Businesses and schools, anything non-residential, is required to remove turf that does not serve a recreational purpose in the valley. We estimate that there's 3,900 acres of this turf. It exists in medians, streetscapes, the areas of parks that no one accesses are too steep to walk on. We are just implementing this, and in January, the criteria that a citizens committee defined for non-functional turf will go to our board, and all of the affected properties have until 2027 to remove that turf. Another thing that we're taking to the board as a proposed action is to limit the surface area of pools. We have restricted turf in the landscape, and we found that particularly on the luxury home scale, people have replaced that with excessively large pools. This does not save a significant amount of water because there aren't tons of these going in, but it's very important that a few water users not be able to behave badly. We do have to acknowledge that we live in a desert, regardless of how big our lot size is. Reducing our golf course water budgets. So our golf courses today get just over 6 acre feet per acre. There is a monetary penalty for exceeding that budget. Our golf courses have adjusted and managed well to that. You can see their water use here on the right. Over our average local course is using 4.1 acre feet per acre. So we're going to propose lowering that budget to about 4 acre feet per acre to be consistent with the average use of a course in the Southwest region. The next proposed action that we are considering is a complete prohibition on the installation of turf, excepting in schools and parks. We have found through our community that as lot size and development patterns change, you can have a very livable space that does not necessarily need live grass. Live grass uses about 75 gallons per square foot in this valley. It's a water use we can't afford, and it's very hard to manage when it's in people's backyards. We've surveyed through aerial imagery and estimate that there's about 480 acres of turf being installed in the valley every single year, just as a result of people landscaping their backyards, putting in new schools and parks. So we're restricting this to where only schools and parks may have turf in the future. And then our final proposed action is a moratorium on the use of evaporative cooling. Behind irrigation, that's the second largest consumptive use of water in this community. It's one that the industry as a whole has a very hard time getting their hands around. There are alternative cooling technologies that exist, but the only way we're going to accelerate their implementation here locally is if we force folks to have to do it. So we're taking this action to ask the board to adopt a moratorium for several years so we can explore the use of alternative technologies. This chart is a very granular look at how we anticipate every single one of our conservation measures will affect our water use on a gallon per capita per day metric. I didn't go over every single one of these, but you can see that we have a plan here to not only take into account our current use, but the upward pressure projected from climate change and implement a series of programs that will enable us to get to 86 gallons per capita per day by 2035. And with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Tom. Tom Buschatzke with. I don't think Tom needs an introduction to this crowd, but Tom Buschatzke is with the Arizona Department of Water Resources.
Thanks, Colby, and good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk a little bit about the 500-plus plan, but I need to start with some background for context. So again, the Lower Basin Drought Contingency Plan intended to reduce the risk of Lake Mead falling to critical elevations, and in particular, that elevation at 1020. At 1020, we don't have much of a buffer for Lake Mead falling to perhaps the dead pool that Colby talked about earlier. And that could happen perhaps as quickly as within 1 year. When the states developed the proposal that was incorporated into 2007 guidelines, the risk of Lake Mead falling below 1020 through the period, 2026, was estimated just less than 10%. By 2019, when we entered into the DCP, that had risen to just below 60%. The DCP got that back down to under 10%. In the August 24-month study this year, that risk has risen again to near DCP levels, again, just below 60%. So we had an adaptive management provision in the Lower Basin Drought Contingency Plan that basically said if in any 24-month study, if the minimum probable inflow projection that Lake Mead will be at or below 1030, so any time in that 2-year period looking forward, the Secretary and the lower division states shall consult and determine what additional measures will be taken. And there was a commitment to individual and collective action to avoid and protect against the potential for elevations in Lake Mead to decline below 1020. Again, it's very telling that we use the minimum probable projection. It was a very conservative way to look at this. So the 1030 consultation revision was triggered in the August 24-month study, and I think we knew that the tier one shortage was coming before that study was published. We really didn't know that the 1030 consultation trigger was going to be hit, except right a few days before the August 24-month study was published. So the states, California, Nevada, and Arizona, started working diligently very quickly when we came to that conclusion that the trigger was being hit. So the numbers I'm about to talk about in terms of what you need to do additionally to protect the lake, which is now the 500 plus plan, are in addition to the DCP and 07 guideline reductions. So we looked at 250,000 acre feet each year for 5 years. We looked at 500,000 acre feet. We looked at 750,000 acre feet through modeling. Obviously, the 750,000 acre feet would be more robust, but we settled on discussions of the 500,000 acre foot number because we thought that we could get there in the first 2 years of our plan. Again, we knew that we were under a very short time frame and that if we could get more than 500, that would be a great outcome, but we really targeted that 500 plus plan number. So again, today we are signing an MOU among the parties for the 500 plus plan. We expect our efforts to continue through 2026, but the MOU does provide specificity for 2022 and 2023, but provides a framework for further actions in 2024, 2025, and 2026. Again, we're taking voluntary measures to reduce water use by at least 500,000 acre feet each year in the next 2 years. We're going the voluntary route instead of forcing shortages on our water users. There are many reasons for that, but for me, forcing additional shortages on our water users in Arizona could potentially force me to go to the legislature to get approval to sign on to that type of a plan. I do not need to do that for the 500 plus plan because it is voluntary. So the non-federal parties to the MOU that we're signing today have identified $100 million to contribute towards the compensation for those voluntary reductions. $40 million of that's coming from my department, $20 million from Southern Nevada Water Authority, $20 million from the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, and then $20 million for the CAP. As we heard Commissioner Touton speak about earlier today, they are also signing the MOU with us and are committed to the plan, and she talked about $200 million in total for those 2 years, and if I can still do math, that means the U.S. is contributing $100 million along with the $100 million from the state parties. So to explain how this plan works and the effectiveness of this plan, I need to share with you that when we did the modeling, we understood that there was conservation already embedded in the June 24-month study put out by Reclamation and in the August study and every study since then. There's conservation already embedded in that plan. So we need to do 500,000 acre feet a year in addition to that conservation already embedded in the plan or the reductions in DCP and 07 guidelines. So the way we modeled the positive results of staying above 1020 in our 500 plus plan was to put in additional water over and above what either was in the 24-month study or what was anticipated to come out of Lake Mead in that 24-month study. So in some cases, some entities were going to take intentionally created surplus out of Lake Mead, and part of the 500-plus plan is now some of those entities leaving their intentionally created surplus in the lake, thus bending that modeling curve compared to the baseline over the summer for the Reclamation's modeling. And so we're looking at doing, creating potentially additional intentionally created surplus and having that water stay in the lake through 2026. I think that's part of what the Gila Rinne community is signing on to today. John alluded to that in his opening remarks. They're also doing some system conservation. The Colorado Rinne tribes are also signing today for additional conservation. And then other folks are also creating reductions in their historical use for system conservation as well, within at least California, I believe, and Arizona. And again, Nevada is putting money onto the table under the MOU. Again, we recognize that we need to comply with all applicable environmental laws for the implementation of the MOU. And again, not all of the potential water reductions we are identifying to date are ready for prime time in terms of an announcement today. But again, I will go through some of the entities, at least in Arizona, that we are talking with. We do have, we think, the 500,000 acre feet and a little bit more cobbled together for 2022 and close to that for 2023. But again, there's many boards, councils, et cetera, that have to take action. So we don't want to get ahead of them in terms of announcing specific volumes attached to specific parties. But in Arizona, I already mentioned the Gila Rinne community, the Colorado Indian tribes. We have participation by the Salt River Project, and of course by the Central Arizona Project. We have the Mojave Valley Irrigation and Drainage District, the Welton Mohawk Irrigation and Drainage District, the Yuma Mesa Irrigation and Drainage District. We have several cities, El Mirage, Gilbert, Glendale, Phoenix, Scottsdale, Surprise, Tempe. We have the Harquahala Valley Irrigation District. We have the Queen Creek Irrigation District and the City of Mesa. These names probably might not mean a lot to everybody, but I offer them to show kind of the collaboration that it takes to get something like this done. And we're talking with all those parties about the specifics in terms of the contracts we would enter into them for the volumes of water and the resources that we will pay those folks under those agreements. So again, we will have more information as we continue to negotiate these agreements. We know that a lot of the agreements won't actually be negotiated, signed, sealed, and delivered into early next year, January, February, even to March. But the key is to have those agreements signed, sealed, and delivered in a way that Reclamation, as is its normal practice, will be able to count that water as being conserved in the model, and we want to see that happen by the August 24-month study for 2022, so we can see the bending of the curve. We can also see how that might impact the tier level shortages. Again, we'll definitely be in tier one. We're flirting with tier two for 2023, and perhaps an ancillary benefit of the 500 plus plan might be keeping us out of a tier two shortage in 2023. But that remains to be seen, and certainly the report from Dan this morning was not encouraging in that regard. So hopefully I was brief enough to stay on time here, Colby. But again, this afternoon at 1 o'clock, and I believe it's in this room, Palace 3, we are having a signing event, so you're all welcome to attend. The various agreements that John alluded to in his opening speech will be signed on stage at that point in time. And then we're going to have a brief press conference with those participants. So it's going to be from about 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock. We know it probably overruns the 1:30 panel, but we'd love to see some folks here for that signing event. And I think it's a great opportunity to show the world, as we've shown the collaboration in this basin, that we're stepping up to the plate. And many of the parties who've been working with us in the past stepped up again to work with us on this 500 plus plan. And I think the optics of this event are really important to continue to confirm the partnerships that many of us have talked about. So with that, Colby, I'll conclude my remarks.
Thank you, everyone. And just and thank you, Tom. We did overrun our time and we were kind of planning on that. We are not going to take a break for the raffle right now, and we're going to call the next panel of speakers up. If you have to use the restroom, please feel free to step out, but we're going to try and keep the time clock on track. And I just want to say thank you again to this great panel for coming and talking about some of the challenges that we're facing today.
Thank you, Colby.
Sawyer mean pride. Good morning, everybody. If I could ask you to take your seats, and we're going to begin the next session. And I hope they will stop the music at some point. Thank you. Well, no, they haven't stopped it. Now they have stopped the music. Good morning, everybody. I'm Sharon Megdal. I'm director of the Water Resources Research Center at the University of Arizona. I have the pleasure of moderating this panel, and I like to note that unlike the last session that was for 45 minutes with four speakers, we're 45 minutes with two speakers, starting late, but we've allocated more time per speaker as a result. So we're probably starting late, going to run a little bit into the next time because the speakers have prepared some very important presentations for you. And I want to note, just to kind of set the stage, our session is Changing Climate, Acknowledging the Water Risks. And if you've looked at the agenda, just about every session has the word change in it. And this is all about change. We've heard so much already. But it's also a lot about uncertainty. And our speakers are going to talk about some of the uncertainties and some of the things that we may be looking at from the science modeling perspective. And then also from the Bureau of Reclamation, we're going to hear about how they're kind of updating some of the approaches. And we saw from Dan Bunk earlier this morning some of those traces and those figures. And we're going to see how they're going to be changing a little bit about how they're going to be presenting that information to help us deal with some of this deep uncertainty. So with that, I'm really pleased to turn it over to Brad Udall, who's going to talk about Colorado River trends, projections, and planning. And I know Brad wanted to stand up here to make his presentation. And he's tall, and I'm not. So I just realized I don't have a little thing to step on.
So
Brad doesn't need it.
Good morning, all. Nice to see all of you. My name is Brad Udall. I'm a senior scientist at Colorado State University. I took this image at the now-closed Bullfrog Marina Car Ferry in October. And if you look carefully, you can see Lake Powell out there in the distance. This ferry was running up until mid-year, and because of the 55-foot-plus drop in Lake Powell, it went out of business. So let me tell you an overview of what I want to talk about. Every trend shown in this image is going in the wrong direction. How can 85% or 90%, as it said earlier today, turn into 30% runoff? I have a whole series of worrisome projections, many of which we've already seen. I then want to go through about eight different scientific studies. And I want to make a point that what we're in is not a drought, and it's not actually a new normal with due respect to the commissioner. It's something else. And then finally, I want to close on what to plan for. The image on the right here I've been producing since 2017, and it has four different trend lines on it. Combined contents of Mead and Powell, upper basin natural flows, precipitation in the basin, and then temperatures. And let's look at each one of these. So here's combined Mead and Powell volume from 1935 to 2021 on the horizontal axis, contents on the vertical axis. In January 2000, Mead and Powell were 95% full, shown there, 47 million acre feet. By April of 2022, Powell and Mead are going to be less than 30% full, or 15 million acre feet, right there. It's a loss of 32 million acre feet, two times the annual flow as measured by 20th century average, and more like 2.5 times the current average of 12.3 million acre feet. And I want you to look also at this and tell me, do you see any fills in this 22-year period? Any fills of these reservoirs? And the answer is really not. There's one time period here in 2011 where it actually jumps up right there. But then we immediately lost that in 2012 and 2013. So on the right is a photo I took at the height overlook at the upper part of Lake Powell again in October. The Colorado River has returned, right? On the left is a stock photo from the year 2000 when the reservoir was full. Now, these two images speak for themselves as to what's happened to this reservoir. All right, the second trend I want to talk about is the decline in leaf fairy natural flows. That is to say, the flows that would exist were humans not around. And in this case, I've now plotted the flows in bars, going back to 1906. And how different are these flows from the 20th century average, 1906 to 1999? So the two means are 15.2 million acre feet in the 20th century and 12.3, or minus 19%. And you can see them highlighted there in blue. High flow years are now occurring half as many times as they did in the 20th century, and that's why we're not getting the reservoir fills. Low flow years, less than 10 million acre feet, are now 2.5 times as frequent. If you try and do a very simple Monte Carlo analysis and recreate the last 21 years sampling from the 20th century flows, you only get these kind of numbers once every 1,500 years. It's also worth looking at the worst 22-year period from 1906 to 1999. That's 13.1 million acre feet versus, again, the 12.3 that we've seen in the last 22 years. That's a difference of 800,000 acre feet per year, or roughly 17 million acre feet. So next spring, instead of looking at 15 million acre feet, we'd be looking at more than 30 million acre feet in those two reservoirs, and we would be having a fundamentally different conversation. So take home, the last 22 years has no 20th century analog. They're completely different. Let's look at unregulated inflows into Powell during this same period. And these are the actual inflows into Powell with the effects of upstream reservoir operations removed. If you added upper basin demands back into these, you'd have something that looked like natural flows. The 22-year average is actually 8.4 million acre feet a year. And what's really interesting about this is that these inflows tie directly into Compact Section 3D, the non-depletion provision, the 75 million acre feet that the upper basin nominally promised the lower basin. And if you do some math here, if you take evaporation of 0.5 million acre feet out of the 8.4, you're left with 7.9 million acre feet per year. That's what you could release over the long term from Powell. And it's super important to note that that number is less than the annualized 3D plus Mexico non-depletion amount, 8.23 million acre feet, which implies that at some point in the next few years, were these flows to continue, and I fully think they will, we're going to have a real interesting discussion about what that section 3D means. What does it really mean? All right, let's look at precipitation declines during this same period. So this image has the years on the bottom, inches of precip across the top. There are four lines on there, a horizontal 20th century average in dots. The up and down are the annual data. There are two linear trends in red, and then finally a very fancy smoothing line called low S that's like a moving average. We've had the worst 22 running average going back to 1895 for precipitation in the Upper Colorado River Basin. And the lows are record-setting and numerous and have no analog in the 20th century. So there's 2018, single worst year since 1895. There's 2020 in the bottom 10. There's last year in the bottom 20 of all years. There's 2012 in the bottom 10, 2002 bottom 10, 2000 bottom 20th. So a third of the years since 2000 are in the bottom 20, and you can see them all right there. And visually, take that blue box and move it to the left, and you will not find another period like that. The highs are also lower than many of the 20th century highs, which fits with this idea that we're not getting these large flow years. And then finally, large temperature trend here since 1970, that dashed red line. Temperatures are up 3 Fahrenheit, or 1.7 Celsius, and you can see it right there, and that's 3 Fahrenheit. And the other thing that's worth noting here is that we've not had a single year after 1999 below the 20th century average, not one of them. All right, second part of my presentation, how can 85% or 90% of April 1 snowpack turn into 30% of runoff? This image here shows 13 inches of snow water equivalent in the spring of 2021. In the 20th century, the conventional wisdom that only winter precipitation mattered. But it's a little known fact that in the Upper Colorado River Basin, precipitation occurs almost evenly throughout the year. Since 2000, the precipitation declines have actually been quite uneven on a monthly basis. So we've seen a small decline from October to February, fall into winter, and large declines in March and April, plus June, July, and August. What happens is that the March and April declines allow for early run-up, early runoff, and early green up. And if you know a little bit about really big years in the Colorado, it snows well into May in these years. So these early declines in precipitation, March and April, are very problematic. And then finally, the June, July, and August precipitation declines plus high temperatures dry out soils. And here's an image that shows soil moisture as of July 19th last year. And those red colors are 10 and 12 inches of soil moisture deficit versus the 13 inches of snow water equivalent we had on April 1. Looking at the two images, it's not hard to understand why we didn't get much runoff out of that 85% snowpack. So the answer and insights, of course, are the previous year dry and hot summers, along with early spring sharply reduced runoff, and dry soil moisture serves as a memory from one year to the next. And of course now, summer precipitation is important. And I want to note today at the huge AGU, American Geophysical Union meeting that's going on in New Orleans, there's an important study out of NOAA that suggests the monsoon die-up that we've seen in many years, especially in 2020, may in fact be a feature we're going to get to live with. All right, let's look at some recent Colorado River Basin peer-reviewed studies. So this is a study on snowpack, a low to no snow future, and its impacts on water resources in the western United States. Brand new study, in fact, has a Denver water scientist on it. This study suggests that low to no snow areas in the Upper Colorado River Basin could move from 20% now to 60% of the basin by 2060. Here's a groundwater study from this year by USGS scientists that suggests by end of the century, 30% declines in the groundwater base flow that feeds our river. This study is the one that perhaps bothers me the most because it suggests that the precipitation declines in the last 22 years are actually human caused, done by a very well known scientist and a number of University of Colorado authors. This study in Science last year by USGS authors suggests that the flow loss in the Colorado River Basin is around 9% per degree Celsius warming. And they actually make some projections that I'll talk about later. This study ties into the soil moisture issue. So these scientists, well known from a number of Western universities, indicate that the last 19 years have the second worst soil moisture in the last 1,200 years. So June, July, August soil moisture here. Again, in Science. This older study by Connie Woodhouse talks about how a given amount of precipitation is actually now generating less runoff, and this occurs both in high flow and low flow years. And then I want to note that up to half of the flow loss we're seeing in the basin has been attributed to humans. And these are two of the papers that have my names on them on this topic. So when I hear new normal, I actually get a little frustrated. It's a clever term, but let me tell you why I object to it. If you're going to call this anything, call it the new abnormal. Because what we're seeing is not anything related to normal. Normal implies predictability. This climate is not stationary. It is going to continue to change. And so this is not really a drought. It's not really a new normal. It's a new abnormal, if anything. And numerous scientists have actually given this a new term. It's a mouthful, I admit. It's called aridification. And you can see the whole list of things here that deal with aridification. All right, let's look at some projections. We've seen some earlier. I want to talk about Mead. I want to talk about Powell Power. I want to talk about upper basin water delivery. Mead at or below 1025, what's the problem here? You know, we have inadequate rules. The reservoir is 20% full. So this reclamation study, a five-year projection, shows we have a greater than 25% chance starting in 2023 of being below 1025, and it increases through time. Gets up around 60%. What about Powell at or below 3525? That's that 35-foot buffer on top of the penstocks. Problem, we lose power. When greater than 40% every year for the next 5 years, including 90% shown next, roughly 90% next year, and there it is. And then let me talk about something that often has not been talked about, which is a violation of that 3D water delivery, whatever it is, commitment obligation, non-depletion obligation in the Colorado River Compact. Dan Bunk mentioned how Powell is now in the two lower tiers and looks like it will be for the foreseeable future. And those tiers mandate releases of either 7 million or 7.5 million acre feet. And with a little bit of math, you can see that that 3D 75 million acre feet, or 82.3 actually, could be violated as soon as 2025. And I want to note two things. These are not independent events, right? And if one of them happens, likely more of them will happen. And then finally, I want to note that the Bureau of Reclamation inflows that are used in this modeling actually go from 1991 through 2020. So they include 10 years of the 20th century, and those years are quite wet. And while it's difficult to exactly determine how much wetter they are, that number could be at least a million acre feet per year too high. And what it suggests is that these numbers I've just told you are in fact too low. Yeah. So this comes out of some work Kevin Wheeler's done, Utah State University, Center for Colorado River Studies. And what happens if we assume the 2021 drought continues with current operating rules? Powell and Mead decline to 6 million acre feet. If the upper basin demand increases per its new 2016 demand schedule, we have the existing interim guidelines and DCP lower basin cuts. 6 million acre feet is the average outcome if you do that going forward. And that just assumes with the current drought. So let's look at leaf fairy flows and temperatures. Leaf fairy flows, a whole bunch of different studies. Over Peck and I in 2017 projected up to 30% losses by mid-century using only temperatures, which we say are the best use of the climate models, with flat precipitation. And then the two USGS scientists, Millie and Dunn, projected plus 5 to -40% if you use both precipitation out of some of the wetter climate models plus temperature changes. And the state of science report shown here, the cover suggests that there's a strong tendency toward lower runoff. Upper basin temperatures, the current trend has another degree Celsius by 2050, but the models say you could almost more than double that if we get unlucky with land surface feedbacks. So let me end with this. What to plan for? This is a editorial that John Fleck and I wrote in Science earlier this year called Managing Colorado River Risk: Will Decision Makers and Politicians Follow the Science? So given all that I've talked about, these trends that are in the wrong direction, the fact that our climate system is non-stationary and is changing in ways that almost always are bad, that we have a number of tipping point probabilities here that are too high, and the fact that we only control demand, what should we do? I would suggest that to avoid what I call water management malpractice, we have to anticipate that future inflows will be less than the last 22 years, less than 12.3 million acre feet. How much less? In this editorial, John and I didn't go into details on what it was, but I would suggest that 11 million acre feet is at least a reasonable number. It's additional 10% loss less, and maybe we should think about more if we can come up with a reasonable worst-case future that's both politically possible to plan for and supported by the science. And here John and I say, only by planning for even greater declines can we manage the real economic, social, and environmental risks of running low on a critical resource upon which 40 million North Americans depend. And I would suggest we've got two options here, piecemeal or holistic planning options. And I'm worried that piecemeal or incrementalism, like we've pursued since 2000, it's unlikely to prepare us for these coming changes. Tipping points that I've and others have talked about indicate lurking law of the river problems. And I would suggest, where are our new Delph and Delphina carpenters to lead us to a brighter and better future? And I actually have, despite all kind of the gloom and doom here, optimism that this basin has the resources, has the wherewithal, the people to get this done. But it's going to take everybody in this room pulling forward. So with that, I'll stop and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Brad. That was great. Well, Jim Prairie, are you going to do it from up there? Okay, so Jim Prairie is hydrologic engineer, and I just want to share, I'm glad Brad ended with a little optimism, because when I was invited to moderate this panel, I thought, oh, great, we get to be the bad news panel. And so Brad, thank you for introducing that little bit of optimism there. So I'd like to turn it over to Jim Prairie from the Bureau of Reclamation. Jim.
Thank you, Sharon, and thanks, everyone. I am working with the Upper Colorado Basin region, and I'm the team lead for our research and modeling team out of the Upper Colorado River Basin. And what I'm gonna be talking about today is some work we've been completing over the last 3 years, really getting to prepare us for this concept of a non-stationary climate, water supply, and the changing that Brad's talked about. So some of the concepts I'd like to talk about is how we're hoping to help add some tools for us to analyze and address that as we move towards this post-2026 negotiation. So what I wanted to begin with is what we're commonly talking about, and I think what you heard this morning, is this risk in the basin that we're seeing. And really the way we interpret risk is through that modeling process you saw this morning, where we model many different plausible traces, we count them up, and we see how many are falling below a threshold of interest. And today I want to be focusing on the threshold of interest of Lake Powell falling below the minimum power pool, or 30 for 90. You'll see me using that throughout. And that is the definition that is predicated on this idea of a stationary climate, stationary hydrology. As long as we have that, we can look at this risk and be confident that it's telling us our future risk. And we're seeing limitations with that. You're hearing that many times during this conference today. And what we need to do is we need to be able to work on thinking, how can we move away from relying on risk that thinks about climate as stationary? So what I'd like to talk about is walk you through some ideas here and how we're working towards this concept of bringing in deep uncertainty, or the understanding that we have a changing risk. And that'll be reframing the analysis that you've seen. And the two terms I'd like to bring out today are vulnerability and robustness. And I'd like to show you how we look at those terms and how we'd like to bring those terms into the discussion. So what I'm showing right here is a figure that is showing Lake Powell elevation, and it's the risk of falling below 3490. And on the x-axis, you're seeing that percent of traces. And on the x-axis, you're seeing the years 2021 through 2026. And right here, I'm showing the hydrology that was used in the 2007 interim guidelines. And it shows the risk using that hydrology of that event. And we're seeing by 2026 a risk of 1%. And now we're sitting here looking at that risk increase significantly. And on the right-hand side, what you're seeing is what we call a box plot that lets us see the distribution of that flow that's being used. And to the right of the box plot is what we call a violin plot, which gives a picture of that distribution of flow. And you can see that it's distributed a little low over that range that's being shown. Now, as I take this to a new hydrology, we can look at that hydrology we did before was 2007. We only had it through 2005 then. We've now extended it through 2019. We can see that that box plot is slightly decreased, that distribution has decreased, and our risk has moved up a little bit. we change to a new hydrology, this is using information coming from the global climate model. So this is looking at the coupled modeling intercomparison project 3. You can see that that range has increased significantly, but that interquartile range, that box you see, has shifted down. So we're seeing on average some lower flows, you see the whole distribution shifting down, and you see the risks significantly increase. And this is just another view of a possible future. If you go another step further, they've moved to the coupled modeling intercomparison project 5. Under this, now we're seeing it shift up again a little bit. Does that really mean anything? I would argue it does not necessarily. It's not something we should think that we're better off. We've still got this very wide range. And if we go to what you've traditionally been seeing lately, Reclamation using, is the stress test. The stress test is from 1988 to 2019. And you can see now we've shifted down again. These are all plausible futures. And picking any one is really difficult. And you can see under the stress test, the risk is on top of everything else. So we have a wide range of what could happen, and we need to rethink this idea of risk. So what we've been working towards is this reframing of the analysis and adding some more tools to the analysis we're going to do and bringing in the concept of vulnerability. So risk is asking the question, what is the probability of Lake Powell falling below 3490 or minimum power pool? And what we can see is that risk can change significantly very quickly. And that is something people didn't expect when we first walked into this. And we're highly dependent on these assumptions of that future hydrology. That future hydrology drives the risk. And if we pick wrong, are we going to get the wrong risk? We want to move away from that paradigm. So what we want to do is we want to move towards this concept of vulnerability. And under vulnerability, what we're going to ask is, what conditions would likely cause Lake Powell to drop below 3490? And we're going to base this on observable conditions, things like Lee's Ferry flow. Can we look at Lee's Ferry flow and see a certain level that's going to cause the vulnerability of us dropping below 3490? And this provides us an objective measure to start thinking about our decisions we're going to be making. So what I'm showing now is a lot of information. I'm going to distill it down pretty quickly. We're looking at pool elevation on the y-axis and the years again, our monthly data from 2021, January through December 2026. And you're seeing all those traces of hydrology I showed, we've now pooled them all together. And there's 332 different possible futures we could see. And what we're saying now is we're not gonna distill this down to risk. We're gonna analyze this data with some different methods, the methods that are in the deep uncertainty academic framework. And what we can do is we can pull out of here what are those vulnerable traces. Of those 332, there are 30 traces that show the vulnerability of dropping below 3490. And we can go further and say, what is driving that vulnerability? And if we look at a five-year average flow, we can see from 2021 to 2026, when we see flows at or below 11.4 million acre feet, we see this vulnerability arising. So that becomes a metric that we can track. And we can look at this in the past further. We can look at it at different times. And this is a methodology where there is a framework to hunt for this information. And to give it context, from 2017 to 2021, we had 11.5 million acre feet of flow. So we are right on the cusp of that point where we're seeing that vulnerability. So this is the type of information that we can start to provide sooner to help us prepare or recognize we're on that path towards that vulnerable state. And you can do it for many different variables. I'm just showing an example of minimum power pool, since that's on Reclamation's mind very heavily right now. So what we can do is, I've only shown you the next 5 years. You can extend these risk profiles you've seen out to 2050. And here I've extended them out. You're seeing that those risk profiles can kind of shift and change. The stress test is no longer the worst case scenario when you go out to 2050. Now that CMIP-3 based ensemble is the worst case. But again, this changing risk is something we have to recognize is continue to occur. So we need to be able to put some new tools into our analysis that aren't dependent on a risk that relies on a stationary climate hydrology. We don't have that anymore. I fully agree with Brad. So we're going back to that vulnerability analysis. It's the same type of information. We've got pool elevation on the Y, the years through 2050 now on the X-axis. And now we're looking at those same 332 possible futures. And now we're doing that analysis to see any month that one of those futures drops below 3590, and we're seeing that 113 are dropping below. And now we're saying, Under this analysis, we've searched for a 10-year mean flow. And the 10-year mean flow, less than or equal to 12.2 million acre feet, is what's leading to these types of vulnerabilities. And we can see from 2012 to 2021, we were well below this level. We were at 11.8 million acre feet. So we are on that track of being below 3490 if we do nothing different from what we're doing today. And that's really the key point there. We have the opportunity to try and change this. And that's where we're hoping that this decision-making under deep uncertainty will become a tool that can help us reevaluate this information, not basing it purely on risk that depends on stationary climate, and to be able to look at futures that are changing and be able to think about those and work through those. We recognize that it is impossible for us to predict which of those hydrologies I showed you is the one we're going to realize. So that risk that we showed under each of those, we don't know which one's going to come up. So what we want to do is work under this decision making under deep uncertainty. The acronym DMDU is what's used for this in the academic literature. And what it's going to let us do is incorporate these concepts of vulnerability and then second, what we call robustness. And what that's allowing us to do is the vulnerability, I just showed you how we can begin to discern that, learn from it. And what robustness is doing is saying, what if we put new policies in place? Do we see a shift in the vulnerability? Are we reducing it? And as we reduce it, we can reduce it to flow thresholds that we want. We don't have to pick 11 million acre feet, 9 million acre feet. We can basically move through and see how we can change the vulnerability and walk towards what are the trade-offs. And we can move through that process. And that will, we believe, allow us not to get hung up on this choice of a hydrology or choice of what we think the future is going to be. If we understand the system better and look at these vulnerabilities, and we can do it across not just the reservoirs, we can do it across environmental metrics, and it'll give us a new way to really think about what can we do in this space and what are the trade-offs we may need to make. So in summary, I just want to speak to, you know, the projections of risk are always going to be based on imperfect assumptions. These are projections that we're making assumptions of what we think is going to happen and that may not come about in the way we expect. This concept is critical that low risk does not mean no risk. When you see 2% risk, don't sit and think that's not going to happen. We are experiencing it today. So we need to think about how can we make our system robust across a wider range of potential risks. And I recognize there's trade-offs with cost and such, but we need to have that open conversation of looking at it. And then we also want to work to help identify these vulnerabilities for different metrics of interest and help to assess how can we become more robust in the system. How can we move away from this over-reliance on assumptions that are based on risk in a stationary assumption? And then last, really, I'm hoping you'll see more of this decision-making under deep uncertainty or DMDU methods. We are planning to continue to roll these out, help people understand how they can be useful, and really want these to be a component of what we're going to use as we move into the post-2026 discussions, and potentially even the discussions we're going to have for the next 5 years as we work through the state we're in at this point. Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you, Jim. That was great. You know, I want to thank both of our presenters for covering actually a tremendous amount of work and compilation and knowledge in such a short period of time. And I think, Jim, as you ended your remarks, you're going to help roll it out, help some of us who may need help understanding it, understand it, because some of you we know are very well-versed in some of these modeling and all that, but others are more users of your science and your results, and so we need that help, and I want to thank you both for being so clear and so brief, you know, such clarity in your briefness. But we picked up time, if you noticed. I had questions. We're not going to do them. We're going to try to keep on time because people want to go to lunch. So just in closing, I just want to share, and I'll go back to the optimism of Brad, and I think in general, we know we have bad conditions out there. The symptoms are not good, but we're trying to address them, and I sense a sense of optimism throughout. And I give a lot of talks, and I often will show the glass half full, half empty, and I guess we're only 37% full, so maybe I need to kind of have somebody do me a glass better. But I often say, you know, which part of the glass I focus on depends upon whether I wake up optimistic or pessimistic for the day. And I think we're optimistic here. And I think it's partly, and this word it came up in Brad's presentation, I think, because the stakeholders are all taking a holistic look at the situation. I mean, not just looking at the supply side, we're looking at the demand side, we're looking at the natural resources implications and the cultural implications. And so we have a lot of work done being done on this holistic look. And as Commissioner Touton highlighted in her remarks, is that there's a lot of innovation, lots of collaboration going on, and that's what we need and what it will take. And so I know through the rest of this conference, we'll hear more and more about all of that. And so I look forward to that. And again, please thank me in, please join me in thanking our panelists. Thank you. I believe the next panel's coming up, right? There is another panel. Ann Castle is the moderator. I see her at least. It's a little hard with these lights.
Just a small town girl living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going. A singer in a smoky room, a smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile they can share the night. It goes on and on and on and on. Strangers waiting up and down the boulevard. Their shadows searching in the night.
Okay, we're gonna get started. I know it's been a long time without a break, but here we are. So my name is Ann Castle. I'm with the Getches Wilkinson Center at the University of Colorado Law School. And it's my pleasure to moderate this panel on vital considerations, which is a panel of voices that maybe haven't been historically loud in connection with Colorado River management discussions and negotiations. We have a great team of panelists. I am not going to give long introductions because we want to use our time for discussion, but I will tell you who they are. First, to my left is Carlos de la Parra, who is the representative of Restauramos El Colorado, an environmental restoration organization in Mexico. Kate Greenberg is next to Carlos. Kate is Colorado's Commissioner of Agriculture and was formerly with she was the Western Regional Director of the National Young Farmers Coalition. Then we have Rosa Long, who is the Vice Chairwoman of the Cocopa Tribe and serves on I can't tell you how many boards and associations. We won't go into that. And lastly is Bart Miller, who is an attorney with Western Resource Advocates and heads the Healthy Rivers program there. I'd encourage all of you to look at their amazing bios in the materials on the website or in the app. But first, we're going to start out with a little review of all the terrible things that you've been hearing about all morning, unfortunately. So current events going on right now, DCP implementation, ongoing hydrology challenges, and the beginning of the 2026 guideline conversations. DCP implementation, we've heard a lot about. There is the elevated contribution and shortage schedule for Lake Mead as a result of the projection that it will be below, and it is below, 1075 elevation. PAL releases are reduced to 7.48 million acre feet. We have the drought response releases from the upper basin reservoirs that you heard about from Sara Larsen and Pat Tyrrell. The 1030 consultation in the lower basin that has resulted in the 500 plus plan that we've heard described this morning by Tom Buschatzke, and the MOU being signed in about an hour and a half. And then demand management investigation, which is ongoing, as you heard. You saw this from Dan Bunk, terrible hydrology, but what we're seeing here is the projections for Pell to go below both the 35-25 target level, which was the level set to protect hydropower generation and the continued ability to deliver to the lower basin, but also a serious chance that PAL could go below 34.90. And I know it's hard to look at these traces, and one way that I think about this is that if the 2022 water year is the same as what we just experienced in 2021, Lake PAL goes below 34.90 by next October, so 10 months from now. And I know you all know the implications of losing power at Lake Powell, but that is such a sobering statistic and ways to think about the future. So what we're going to hear today from our panelists is about different perspectives, different interests in this water management discussion that we're all part of. So first, tribal participation and interests, how does Mexico fit in, agricultural producer concerns, one of which is there always seems to be a target on ag's back. And then finally, we need to think of the Colorado River as not just a delivery mechanism, but a vibrant system of rivers and watersheds. So we're going to hear about all that. To start us off, and we're not going to have presentations, but I've asked the panelists to think about what is the single most important issue that they think needs to be considered, both in the short-term conversations about what do we do about this hydrology, like right now, but in the long-term as well, thinking toward the post-2026 guidelines. So they're going to tell us what the most important issue is in their view and why. So, Carlos, can we start with you?
Sure. So, hi, everyone. An honor to be here. I want to thank CRWUA for the opportunity. I also want to say that Anne introduced me as representative for Restauremos El Colorado. That is true. I'm also an academic at El Colegio de la Frontera Norte and serve as advisor for CELA. Now, let me say that the Mexican section can hear me, but it doesn't necessarily have to be in agreement with what I'm saying. So I just want to clarify that. But in any case, what keeps me up at night as the most important issue that I see in the Colorado River, I think that we really need to acknowledge and preserve the progress that we've made in the binational dialogue. It keeps me up at night to think of years past when the Colorado River between US and Mexico was a zero-sum game. The way I see things, the analysis of the whole system has come into play, and Brad Udall expressed that in the previous session. I view things as the progress we've made is that we have, in many ways, moved from a bilateral water policy between US and Mexico to a regional policy. We now think of our river jointly. In many ways, we need to recognize that because it's not always been that way. Case in point, the All-American Canal. That's when we hit the bottom, and I think that Mexico, after the joint cooperative agreements between 2007 and 2012, has moved from being just a recipient of the water. And many people in Mexicali for a long, long time thought that the Colorado River was a constant source of water. Where does the water come from? The United States, of course. Doesn't come from nature. It comes from the United States. It was just like a faucet. A reliable faucet. Now Mexico is actually a stakeholder. It is a partner, and I celebrate that, and I hope that we keep along that path.
Great, thank you. Kate?
Great, thank you, Anne. And it's a pleasure being with you all here today and getting to serve on this panel. You know, in thinking about this question, of course, a number of things come to mind. It's hard to choose one, but when thinking about what I, you know, kind of want to anchor in throughout all of these conversations and the work that we do in ag in Colorado and across the basin is that these are individual families and individuals who are experiencing the impact of our decisions here. In ag in Colorado, our producers have been dealing with not just the last two or three years of drought, but two decades of drought. Of course, the recent years being some of the most difficult. And since we rely on snowpack, not on storage, that varies every single year what we have to put to beneficial use and to support our ag communities and our ag families. So I think for me, if I were to choose one, it's really going back to that where this hits home for the people out in the field, out in our rural communities predominantly, but urban as well, who are living the impacts of not only our hydrology, but our choices in policy making every single day. And I think that's fundamental to keep in mind as we move forward.
Great, thank you, Kate. Rosa? Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's very difficult to, it was very difficult for me to answer that question. You asked for the single most important issue that we would consider, that I would consider in my tribal perspective when it comes to the Colorado River management. But you know, there's many tribes along the Colorado River who have a voice on how they in measures that they take in conserving water in the Colorado River and the management of it. But one of the single most important issues is to challenge how we currently use our water. The priority system must be honored and continued. As communities grow, and we need to make sure that we have an assured water supply that should hold on until we understand what is the new normal, as the commissioner had stated earlier. It is regarding water availability. That's important. We must be smarter in how we use water. Although agriculture is critical, we must look at crops and ways that we can use less water in the growth of those. We cannot continue to pump groundwater without careful consideration of repercussions to all water users. So that's some of the things that it was a difficult question to just point out one single viewpoint on that.
Well, and we'll be able to expand on all of your answers during the course of this panel, but great start. And Bart.
Thanks, Anne, and thanks for the opportunity to speak at this conference. I think so far this year, we have heard a lot about a shortage and the fact that everyone's experiencing it. And I guess I would highlight what keeps me up at night. Rivers are experiencing shortage. And that's a critical frame to consider as we explore a more sustainable future for the basin. Everyone who's paid attention to the news not only has seen concerns over water deliveries for consumptive uses, but also seen the fact that many of the major rivers in the basin have experienced flows hundreds of cubic feet per second lower than average during summer months. And that's had impacts. Streams and watersheds are struggling in the hotter and drier west that we're hearing all about. And I just want to mention that I think the reason I think it's important to consider protecting and enhancing in-stream uses as we go forward is that they support a wide range of things from recreation, which is responsible for billions of dollars of economic impact and hundreds of thousands of jobs, as well as hydropower, a relatively inexpensive electricity source, and then immeasurable environmental and cultural and sacred values, as well as an economic engine for a lot of local communities. So resilient streams and watersheds feel like they're a really key part of the equation going forward.
Great. The feedback on the first question was that it was hard, but I think I'm now going to ask a harder one. And that is, in the context of what you just said, the issues that keep you up at night, the most important issues for consideration, who are your allies and who are the people who would be adversely affected? So I think it is useful to have that conversation about how we can collectively move forward, because we need to know where our interests align and where there is tension, where we have to have a give and take and have to compromise. So I'm going to reverse the order just to throw everybody off and go to Bart first. So tell us who else is affected by that primary interest in rivers experiencing shortage as well, and for the good and the bad.
Yeah, great question. Certainly the health of rivers and watersheds affects every other stakeholder in the basin. And I see the potential for this to be adversarial, but I see an even better potential for the impacts to be mutually beneficial as we solve for the big problems. I want to give a couple examples. I feel like we heard earlier today about drought operations. Pat Tyrrell talked a fair bit about how that's happened and the emergency operations that took place this year. And interestingly, in the context of 2021, a dramatically bad year of hydrology, the Bureau was able in just a couple weeks to do a lot of outreach to sister agencies to talk about what they could do as they were making emergency releases from upper basin crisp reservoirs. They were able to time those in ways that benefited hydropower. We heard yesterday that $6 million was saved by changing the timing of when water was released from units like Flaming Gorge, and also timing it up to match the needs of endangered fish. And I think that's a little, I want to dwell on that for 10 more seconds. The Endangered Fish Recovery Program is a program that benefits water users across the basin, literally thousands of water users. And the fact that we're able to time some of those drought operation releases to benefit the fish is going to make that recovery program, endangered fish program, beneficial for years to come. So that's one example, I think, that we can look for allies and partnership as we develop options that help rivers and meet water supplies.
Great. And Vice Chairwoman Long, what are you thinking about that?
Well, as you asked these questions to the panel, I went, it's difficult because we have many tribes along the Colorado River that that have a voice in what would primarily affect them, good and bad. So I'm trying my best to be their voice as I'm up here. But everybody obviously deals with agriculture, the uses of it, You know, it's the largest share of water in Arizona. We do need agriculture to help feed the country, but we must evaluate what we can grow with less water versus what we've grown, particularly in areas pumping groundwater. You know, there's a need to have these changes in grade and systems that may require governmental support, as new equipment may be necessary for farmers to shift to different crops. It is also time for developers to be realistic about our drought situation and not rely on groundwater that we cannot replenish in the same time and area that we're drawn that is drawn from. They should work in municipalities and rural areas that have assured water supplies. So it's a conversation that's a little bit more lengthy, but I'm trying to stay on the same point of what we're discussing here.
Thank you. Kate?
I think, you know, the Vice Chairwoman touched on this. Of course, we all eat and we all rely on agriculture, and I think we have natural alliances for those of us who love food to find ways to keep producing it here in this country. We're not the only region in the U.S. that's struggling with uncertainty and sort of the deep vulnerabilities that the last panel discussed in finding ways to produce food in this country, and then in addition in the West, I think will remain critical for us moving forward. But we're under no impression at the Colorado Department of Ag that the future will look the same as it does now. We know it will look different. A few weeks ago, Secretary Vilsack, Secretary of the USDA, was in Colorado announcing $3 billion in support of climate resilience for agriculture. And we were very proud to be the state he chose to make that announcement in. And during his talk, the Secretary talked about two themes, and those were profitability and resilience. And that's really been a large part of our thinking in Colorado and at our department about we know change is inevitable, but how can we support the profitability and resilience of our ag producers and our ag communities as we move into that change?
Carlos?
Yes. So the allies, people, I think civil society in general, and in fact, one of the communities that I would seek additional partnering with is the ag community. And I'm not talking about the ag community in Mexico, I'm talking about the ag community in general, which means US and Mexico, because we have to acknowledge, and this is something that we should tip the hat to the International Boundary and Water Commission about, the US-Mexico border is unlike any other border in the world because the stark differences and asymmetries. And water does not acknowledge borders, yet the agency couples together borders and water. And in that respect, I think that we need to look at the largest water users on both sides of the border is the agricultural community. And I understand that it's not the community itself that's using the water, it's just the activity that we all enjoy of. Looking at on the Mexican side, you have to realize that in 1992, the federal government of Mexico cut the irrigation districts loose from itself, from the federal government. And in that respect, the economic basis for water management and water markets and so forth have been very slow in changing. This is my contention, but given since the 1944 treaty, the only disagreement that has been left as a disagreement between U.S. and Mexico is the All-American Canal. Now that's really noteworthy because close to 80 years and only one disagreement that hasn't been solved is quite remarkable. But the differences are actually, in my view, is just a cross-border difference in water markets. Realize that the lining of the All-American Canal was because of the dynamic nature of water markets in the U.S. and Mexico has been slow to catch up. In minute 319 and minute 323, what we're seeing is the Mexican section on the Mexican side being the leader and pushing towards this bilateral perspective, changing into regional. Following closely behind is the National Water Commission, the Mexican National Water Commission, known as CONAGUA,
it's, you know, trying to catch up at least. And then the ag sector is lagging behind. Climate resilience is still not a reality in Mexicali, in the Mexicali Valley. And I think that that has been the product of such a long-standing time in which water was very, very reliant. The water amounts are now dwindling, and I think that we're going to need this ag community to realize that the NGO community is cross-border in many ways, and hopefully we can work together.
Interesting analogy. The environmental community has really regionalized, I think, across the border issues. Certainly there are cross-border relationships in the ag community, but maybe not as strong. So, Kate, I was hoping you might tell us a little bit more about what actions are being taken in Colorado to deal with the drier conditions that agricultural producers are experiencing. And you mentioned Secretary Vilsack's announcement. What's going to come of that?
Great question. Thank you, Ann. So first off, I will not try and answer the question in complete form because there is much more beyond the bounds of our department at Ag that is going on across the state. Our partners at DNR and the Colorado Water Conservation Board are doing incredible work in supporting our producers and basins statewide in this question. But from our sliver of the pie at Ag, we are focusing in two main areas right now, and this is evolving, and I'll kind of show you the framework that we're building to build off of for the future. I would say the two categories are really around immediate mitigation to the extent that we have resources to do so to support our producers who are hurting in the immediate sense with drought and water scarcity, and then thinking about how do we build longer-term resilience, of course, down the road. In that first bucket, we worked with the legislature and the governor's office and the governor himself, Governor Polis, to move $76 million of state stimulus money through our General Assembly this past session. Now that feels like a drop in the bucket compared to what's coming down federally, but for our state to get behind that amount of state money for agriculture shows our commitment to supporting our farm and ranch families in making it through this time. So a portion of that funding goes to immediate drought relief, certainly not enough to fix the problem, but hopefully enough to help individuals and families and businesses make it through the immediate term. We've also been operating the Ag Impact Task Force, which is part of our state's drought response, one of our many task forces under that drought task force umbrella. Again, working closely with DNR and CWCB to hear what's going on the ground with our producers statewide and then figure out how we act. And actually that stimulus request was something that came out of that working group with our partners in the field. We are also continuing to bring policymakers out into the field. That's something I feel very passionate about. We were able to do that in the Yampa Basin this year, which is experiencing very tough conditions as well, and helping tell that story and elevate that story to folks who don't necessarily live the drought every day. And then when it comes to building resilience for the future, again, we know this is a slice of the pie, but we really hope that our 300-person agency can reorient our work to support our producers and, again, moving through this deep uncertainty. So we are making investments in diversifying revenue streams for producers. That includes really helping advance the conversation around crops that we might be able to grow under much drier and more variable conditions. We are advancing renewable energy development on farms and ranches, supporting agrivoltaics, the emerging kind of system in the U.S. Europe is farther ahead, but where you stack solar development or solar production above livestock rotation or crop production underneath solar panels. So we're looking to advance that work. For the last 3 years, we've been running a soil health initiative, and that just got codified in statute last year. So our soil health program is paying producers to invest in the health of their soil, to keep water in the soil, again, hopefully helping the whole system. Potential for carbon sequestration is there, somewhat less so in the arid west, but we're looking at the potential for us to be a partner there, among the other benefits of soil health. So where all of these fall is under voluntary incentivized stewardship. That's our driving message to our producers in Colorado. We know the world is changing. We want to be at the table, and these are some of the very important solutions that our department, our governor, and our legislature have supported to help our producers make the changes that we need to make for, again, that profitability and resilience. And Ann, you asked the question about the $3 billion.
Yeah.
So we're hoping to get a big chunk of that to Colorado to help advance this work, continue building what we're doing. The last thing I wanted to mention, last year we also passed a bill creating the Agricultural Drought and Climate Resilience Office within our department. That will help us work even more closely with our partners at DNR and CWCB, and then hopefully help us bring in federal money and then have a much more robust policy, science-driven game plan for how we support voluntary incentivized stewardship across our ag sector.
That was a lot.
Yes.
Thank you for that. And it's interesting how those efforts to improve soil moisture retention and pay attention to carbon sequestration relate directly back to what we heard from Brad Udall in terms of loss of soil moisture and how that's affecting runoff and, you know, all one interconnected system. I'm going to come back to Carlos and ask you to go into a little more detail about what you alluded to in terms of the market being different within the agricultural sector in the U.S. and Mexico, and how that has affected the relationship in the past, how you see it evolving in a way that would increase sustainability.
So I think the major difference is in seeing the centralized nature of the Mexican government. And in many ways, the issue in the U.S. is that the agricultural sector has more of a multiple stakeholder conversation. In other words, it relates to cities on water markets, and it relates to local governments as well. Just across the border from the Mexicali Irrigation District is the Imperial Irrigation District. The Imperial Irrigation District, of course, has had negotiations with agencies like the Metropolitan Water District and the San Diego County Water Authority. The irrigation district itself provides basis for water conservation. That is not the case in Mexicali, where it's just the central government dealing with the agricultural community. Over the course of Minute 319 and Minute 323, it took a while for the Mexican farmer in Mexicali to understand that the central government of Mexico, with the International Boundary and Water Commission, had agreed to jump on the boat, on the same boat that provides water for all users in the basin. It was 4 years into Minute 319 that the agriculture community actually started to become, to subscribe to the measures. The NGO community that works in Mexicali has for a long time had a conversation through the central government with the agricultural community. It's about now that Restauremos el Colorado and joined hands with the Nature Conservancy to provide a first study for crop switching to be put on the table as a measure for water conservation. So the Mexicali Irrigation District, the farmers in Mexicali have viewed the changes in the in water management in the binational context as kind of a missing variable or an unknown variable. And it's about time for the NGO community to step forward and to actually begin to partner with them and so that they can understand that the changing of the ground that they're sensing is a good thing. And that hasn't happened because I think of the distance and the centralized nature, as I said, of the Mexican federal government. And I think that right at the border, if no other place in the world, it behooves us to actually begin to push that process.
Really good thoughts. And how do you see it as, what is that message to communicate to ag producers in Mexico that this changing reality is a good thing?
Well, For instance, since Minute 319, the Mexican government actually, by signing on the dotted line in Minute 319, we actually acquired a 1.5 million acre feet reservoir within Lake Mead. So the federal government of Mexico can store the water, but it's now been 9 years and still the feature of being able to store water for future use is just in the hands of the Mexican federal government. It's not for water users at the irrigation module level or at the water utilities of the city of Tijuana or Mexicali or Tecate. This is something that needs to begin to be promoted within water users, within important water users in the Mexicali Valley, so that we can all like jump on board and actually reap the benefits of the binational agreements. There are benefits that are not being so apparent to many water users, including the farmers.
Interesting. And that's a good segue into the next issue that that I've asked the panel to think about, and that is, what are the structures and processes that are necessary in discussions around Colorado River management and operations? What are the structures and processes that are necessary to ensure that the interests that they've expressed are considered and honored in management and guidelines and operations? So I think the need for a process that includes tribal voices has been prominent in the discussions over the last 2 days. And Vice Chairwoman Long, recognizing that you don't speak for all tribal interests, but I wonder if you can talk about what you see for COCOPA as the kind of structure, the kind of process that you'd like to see the major players in the basin use in order to ensure that your interests are considered.
Thank you, Ann. As he just said, we feel your pain about those types of things not being able to be had within your agreement. We too face those challenges of storing and banking our water, and so that's something that we have the right to do as tribes, but in order for that to happen, there's legislation and laws that have to come into play, but you have an agreement and that yet has to be seen. You're right, I cannot speak for all tribes, but I have a general idea of where they stand. We do have the 10 tribes partnership that is represented here at CRWUA. We have all of their flags behind me, which I'm very proud. And we can agree to disagree, but all tribes have one common goal, and that is to protect water and our communities. And so, I heard something that the commissioner said earlier in her address to those present, and that was that she stated that there was a commitment to tribal partnerships, and she also made note that the Gila River Indian community and Colorado River Indian tribes have stepped up. And they are our brothers and sisters, and they have when it comes to the drought. But all of the tribes along the Colorado River have also done so in their own way when it comes to the conservation and preservation of the Colorado River. And so, all our efforts trickle down to all of your areas and your area as well as Mexico. We are just adjacent to the San Andrade Morelos Dam, and so the tribes play a significant part in making sure that your acre feet of water get to you. And also with the ag, we are, some of our tribes, we lease our land with the water that comes along with it. The infrastructure is not there yet. I think a lot of the tribes face the same issues. We have the water you know, we still have to find out what our water allocation, our true water allocation is, quantification and such, and but some of the tribes do not have the infrastructure, and we're hoping that that can come into play with the millions of dollars that you're speaking about.
Yeah, a lot of money for water infrastructure all of a sudden is available. Bart, I'm gonna come to you for some of the last words. What do you think about the structures and processes that need to be put in place or used in order to properly consider environmental interests, and any other thoughts you have about how we go forward?
Well, thanks. Yeah, I think there's many that I could choose from, but I think a couple key ones are gonna be flexibility, that is to enable us to create some solutions and to act on them, and inclusiveness. I think tribal seats at the table and conservation and ag and binational seats at the table are gonna be really critical as we go forward. So I think those are some of the things that I think can be embedded in all of the processes. There's the interim guidelines renegotiation, but as we heard earlier today, a lot of focus in the next couple of years will be on other more immediate things like drought operations and designing and putting up demand management programs. I guess the brainstorm I had as I was flying to this conference, the first flight I've taken in 20 months, I was listening to a book that was written a couple years ago called Sapiens. This is written by a man named Yuval Noah Harari. And he's kind of exploring what led Homo sapiens to be and develop the societies that we have today. And I read someone else who kind of described it. Her name is Amanda Penn, kind of synthesizing this book down to something understandable. And I think it's pretty applicable today, that the notion that at some point in our past we had a cognitive revolution where we our brains changed and we have flexible language that allows us to build plans into the future and to take actions on them. We have gossip in a positive sense where we're actually able to hear about other people and build trust and cooperation through what we hear about people through reputations. And we have the ability to create social constructs, that is things that don't actually exist in real life, but they don't have a physical presence, but they are important things. They're attributes like human rights, inclusivity, corporations. And I think those apply to our situation today in the sense that we need a cognitive revolution to solve the problems of the Colorado River. And all of the interests up here, I don't speak for anyone other than myself, but I feel like we can apply those important attributes using our ability to, through language, to create flexible management structures, to follow through on the plans we make, the commitments made today and that are gonna be made in the next hour, the implementation of those in the coming months and years, the gossip in the positive sense of building trust and embracing new ideas, and then imagining new realities, new assumptions, new data, incorporating those and making them become true.
Very nice. I'm thinking of what Bart has said, and he and I were emailing about this earlier this morning. It's kind of like, in addition to that hydrological shift and the management measures that are necessary to deal with it, we also need kind of a psychological shift in how we think about what we can ask of the river and how that ripples through not just the sort of big picture management decisions and framework, but in our daily lives and the way we put food on the table, for example. This was pretty brief, and we were dealing with huge issues in terms of consideration of these different values. Each of these panelists has a wealth of information and can give you a lot more depth than we've been able to explore in the last 45 minutes. So I encourage you to seek them out and have that discussion if you're interested in delving deeper. But for now, please join me in thanking our panelists, and we'll all go to lunch.